Good morning, Philip Kosten here at Hotel Christiansminde, just slightly east of Svendborg. Next to me is Jochen Richer from Yacht Magazine. Thanks for coming, Jochen.
Thanks, Philip, and good morning everyone who's watching in these early hours of the race.
Well, in about 50 minutes time, the first start of the Silverrudder 2021 is going to be set off. The minis, that's boats, less than 25 feet long. We've got a really exciting fleet of boats from all kinds of different countries. And in a minute, Fleming, our loyal cameraman, will zoom out onto the coast where the first few boats have started moving in towards the starting line. Boats checking out the current, checking the wind direction. Thank you, Fleming. And you'll notice that there are a few ribs out there on the water. One of them is a jury boat right over there on the opposite side with the at the starting buoy at Vinnebu Bridge, just slide to the left, Fleming. And also the Danish harbour, or the Svendborg Harbour master's rib is out there taking pictures. I mean, it's been a party for him having 358 boats in the harbour here. Jochen, you arrived yesterday, didn't you?
Yes.
Tell me, what do you think? What is your first impression of the Silverrudder 2021?
Oh, it's going to be very, very exciting, and I think the first class, the mini class, is just one of the most thrilling ones, because it will be challenging this time, and they're very small boats, you know, 18 footers, and facing some 5 to 6 before up in the north is going to be a challenge. And by the time they arrive, it will get dark, so they have a fun night in front of them. But once they rounded the northeastern corner, Finnshoved, then I think they're in there for the run of their life. And I think I don't think it will be a record Silverrudder, because the weather is not perfect for it. You need a bigger shift. But I think we very likely will see record times up in the north. So I think we have to study these times once the race is over. It will be fun.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that these guys are going to have a hard beat up to the north of Funen along the east coast. But the wind is going to be turning slightly more and more to the east during the day. So they'll end up, when they get to the north of Funen, with what would probably be something like beam winds, maybe slightly after the beam. And that'll be perfect for these guys. They'll get their code zeros and their Jennikers up, and they'll fly across the north of Funen. Let's talk about some of the competitors here. I mean, we've got a really exciting fleet. I just saw an Estonian Mini. Yeah?
Yeah, it's one of the latest generation Skalbau Minis. I think this is the most modern of the minis. I think we have 6 mini transats, and there are 3 protos and 3 serial production boats. The weather is actually favoring this class, because they can take quite a beating, and especially the Skalbau is very, very strong on a beam bridge, which I think will come into play in the morning hours once they're in the Lillebelt. And I think they are less prone to giving up
and to nosediving.
yes. So I think the minis will be fun to watch, then you have so many other races within this class. Races within the race. You have 2 Melches 24. I think you have, of course, the Seascape 18s, the Seascape 24s, which are fun to watch. And then you have newcomers to the race.
Indeed, like we have
the one we see, I think, in front. Isn't this?
This is Seascape. This is Seascape 24. No, it's not Sunny.
Not Sunny. Okay.
Well, let's talk about Sunny Boyko, who's here.
Yeah, I mean, she's probably the most highly decorated Olympic sailor who's starting this year. She just came back from her silver medal in Oshima in Japan, and this is her first big step into her next career, which will be offshore. So I think it's just marvelous for her to start this second phase of her career.
Absolutely.
In Svendborg.
And it's great for Silverrudder. I mean, in fact, there are no less than 3 Olympians here, which is just a sign of the direction that the Silverrudder is taking. That has suddenly got attention. I mean, last year the big deal was that the De La 30 OD had turned up on the fleet here, you know, a boat specifically designed for this type of race. But going back to the minis, other than Susan, we've got some other incredible sailors that we really shouldn't underestimate. I mean, we've got Klaus Röhn in his CB66 now.
Absolutely.
He surprised everybody a couple of years ago by absolutely winning all out, and he's by far the smallest boat and the lightest boat.
Yeah.
He's a tough guy, participated in the Vegvisir and does Funrond. I mean,
I think he won pretty much everything where he started.
He has, yeah.
And he's absolutely fearless. And the boat has quite a potential. It's quite well upwind, and if you're not afraid, it's really fast upwind.
Well, it's surprising the potential that it has. It doesn't look like a boat that has a lot of potential, but Klaus has certainly pushed that boat beyond what one could possibly imagine or expect. I used to race against Klaus and his father back in the Impala 27 days. He didn't used to like me at all, but he's become a fantastic sailor.
He's definitely one to watch.
Yeah.
Then we have Jinx, of course, a long-time Silverrudder competitor.
Patrick Heinrich.
Yes, from Germany in his T24, which is a Swedish design. It's also a very well-rounded boat. It can go upwind very well. It's really blastingly fast downwind. So I think, and then you have the Melchis 24, which have a huge potential as well.
Yeah, but
it's really going to be a question, how well do you manage yourself and the boat when it's really getting tough?
That's right, because in fact there are two Melchis 24s here, and though it's a one design boat, these two boats are very different. They're different in the fact that one of the boat is raced by a Austrian chap who's completely rebuilt his boat. He's got a special extended keel on it. He's put an extra 80 kilos in the bottom of the keel, which is also 80 centimeters longer. He's got a self-tacking jib on there, solar paddle on the front deck. I mean, he's done quite a lot, which will be interesting to see. But his competitor is no less than Anas Bastiansen, who works for X-Yachts.
Yes.
Now, Anas is a bit of a monster, isn't he?
Is he?
Yeah.
He is, absolutely. And I think right there in the foreground, we see the T24 of Patrick right now. Isn't it? Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
it is. He was the first boat on the water this morning.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm quite. I know that he's motivated as much as you can ever get. He's very seasoned. He's very well in tune with his boat, and he has sailed a lot this year. So I think he really wants it. But I want to point out some other boats which are in for a surprise. I think there is a very highly decorated French sailor, actually. To my knowledge, it's only the second who ever started on
the second Frenchman. Yes.
Yeah, it's after Saint-Manoir 3 years ago. This is Émeric Dary, and he's competing in the Seascape 24. We'll see. I think there will be a fight for a good
Emmerich
start.
Emmerich has a world championship or two under his belt, doesn't he? I mean, he's one of the guys that we should really keep an eye out.
He has won the Tour de France à Laval on the DM Trimaran, DM24.
Mm, yeah.
So don't ever underestimate him.
He's a tough guy. And
even though the boat is new to him, I think he's sort of a natural born talent on all the boats. And I'm very, very interested I think it's 6 or 7 or 8 Seascape 24s, and I would put my money on him, even though he's new to the boat.
I think you're right. I mean, the Seascape 24 has a lot of potential as well as sailed properly, but if you're not an experienced Seascape 24 sailor, it's a dead fish in the water. But it really
it's a handful.
Well, I've been racing against one the last few weeks. Actually, there's a boat that's just arrived down here locally, and I was surprisingly unimpressed. And yet, when I've seen other people race them, they're a racing machine.
Yeah.
So I think you're right that Dary is definitely a contender for the win here.
But to be honest, I think it's maybe 5 knots too much wind for the boat to show the absolute full potential. So it will be overpowered.
The signal that you just heard there, ladies and gentlemen, is the 5-minute signal for the first start, which is the minis. And as you can see, the boats are starting to gather well out to the west of the starting line. They're keeping well back. The current is against them. I would say there's about 8 knots, maybe 9 knots of wind out there. Not that much, but remember the waters here are quite sheltered. You can see the flag on the opposite side there. There's not that much wind.
And it's really gusty, as usual, in the Svendborgsund. So in the gust, you can see that there's more in for them once they're out of the sund.
Once you get around what we call Ture Reef, which is probably about an hour's sail from here, then you'll definitely have a lot more wind. We'll probably be looking at something like 18 to 20 knots of wind as they round up from what would be a, a broad reach and come up to probably beating up from here up to the bridge, which is about, depending which boat you're in, about 5 hours from Tourere. So they've got a good beat up wind.
Yeah.
That was the 4 minute signal.
We haven't talked about sort of the other part of the Silverrudder, which is actually the backbone, and it's the sort of more cruising, racing guys, those who come with the boats. They have nothing special, nothing fancy, and it's a very broad mix. We have lake boats like the Sunbeam 22 here, which are quite tippy. We have a gaff-rigged French retro classic, which came all the way from the south of Germany with Martin Heindel, a very nice chap. So let's not forget they will not be first over the line, and they will definitely not be first back in 20.
No, you're absolutely right, Jochen. We must make sure that this race maintains its DNA. I mean, we've got a couple of L23s. We've got Lars Tjernby and his Duet, which is a boat built. I know the guy from my Express sailing days. Well, we actually race against each other. He crews an Express, this is his first Silverrudder. We've got things like a Kingfisher 20 plus, a relatively unknown boat. So they're here probably for the T-shirt. They're probably here because it's on their bucket list. They've heard about the Silverrudder.
Yeah. There you have the Sunbeam in the background with a Code Zero rigged already and the proper mainsail. So I think there is someone on board who does stretch the limits. But these are the boats that can never win, really, and they will have a hard time up in the north because they don't have as much writing moment. But it's so great to see them, and for them it will be much harder to race because the boats are not perfectly designed for long distance solo racing.
We mustn't underestimate. I'd say that these guys in the minis are the real marathon men of this race. I mean, because sitting in a 40-45 foot boat in the weather we're going to be experiencing the next 48 hours, it's not an easy achievement. But I tell you, sitting in a CB66 or a Sunbeam 22, they're going to be tired men and women when they come back to Svendborg.
Interestingly enough, there were not too many guys checking the starting line or checking the current, and it looks like they will all be very conservative at the start.
So it looks like that. There's less than 2 minutes to start.
Which is prudent, because if you're over, you risk getting a 30-minute penalty.
That's right. Yeah.
And you look awful on YouTube.
And on TV, that's right. Yeah. Actually, there's a speckhooker here, which is worth mentioning.
Yes,
Simon
exactly.
Ganske. And Simon is in a Danish speckhooker, which is borrowed, but he's in fact Swiss. Simon and I have been writing to each other and communicating since he registered for the race back in March, and I've rejected 3 boats that he proposed to sail in. Because they're all lake boats, and Simon's going to be a tough guy. And he wanted to, that's 1 minute to the start, ladies and gentlemen. And right in front of the camera, you can see that is Anders Bastiansen in his, it's not his, but the Melgus 24. And I can see that Anders is already ready to pull out his Jenica by the look of things.
Yes.
Does it look like that?
I would not be surprised.
Ready to bear away and reach out of the sound. And I'm not surprised that he is the sailor which is closest to the starting line. Still conservative, though.
Yeah.
He's probably got about another 40 meters, 30 meters up to the starting line. There's about 30 seconds to go.
Yeah.
Patrick Heinrich is just wasting some time. He's just cruising off some time so he doesn't go too fast to the line. But he's ready to attack. He's going out to a very, very nice gust of wind there, just where he is. Look.
Yeah, yeah.
He'll bear away in a very few seconds.
Anders is just sailing along the line and waiting for the gun, and then he's just turning downwind. We see one of the Seascape 24s with the first reef. I think this is Martin Hammershøi.
Okay, that was the start. That was the first start of the Silverrudder 2021. Anders Bastiansen is by far in the lead. But look at this. Patrick Heinrich, as you can see the top right-hand corner.
Yeah.
Stay on the starting line, please, family. There you go. That's Patrick Heinrich with
his
Jenica.
It's not a small thing.
No, it's a huge Jenica that he's setting. He's not going to waste any time. And I'm wondering whether Anders Bastiansen has noticed that Patrick has set that huge, great Jenica on his little T24. T24 is a great boat. They only built 2 of them on the island of Orust, on the west coast of Sweden.
True,
and actually,
yes.
If you're interested, that boat's done really well here, and I know that the mold is still available. And the boat builder has said to Patrick that he'll happily build him a new version if he wants so.
Well,
so that's the start gone.
It's a very conservative start, but as the Silverrudder has proved, you never win it on the start line. It's really in for the long term.
Sure is.
I think that we even see at 24 not even hoisting the the Jenica goes up.
You can see the Melgus 24 that has set his Jenica, and it looks like, you know, they're cruising out of the sound. Some of them haven't even crossed the starting line yet. And most of them are well to windward. They're well over on the Torsinger side, because obviously that's the shortest route.
Yeah.
So they don't want to waste time messing around down here by the starting line. So shortest possible route, full speed. But note that most of the boats start very conservatively, like you, Senor.
Yes, there's a mini all the way in the back, the blue boat. I think this is one of the protos.
I'm looking
with
for
a red spinnaker. Do we see it? No. But he will come into
one.
He will come into interview.
I spoke to him yesterday. This is his third or fourth Silverrudder. I'm looking for a dark grey Seascape 18 with Sunny in it. I think it might be on the other side with the blue Jenica.
Yeah.
Hi, Anders. Welcome.
Hi. She was a bit nervous last night, I have to tell you, when we were set together for dinner. Sunny was getting a bit nervous, and I wouldn't be surprised if she didn't sleep very well. Maybe she didn't even sleep at all, which is not uncommon.
I'm not sure if one could say that the pressure is on her, but I suppose the eyes are on her at least. People think this is a highly professional sailor, a decorated medal sailor. She's got to do well. And I guess that probably means she has to perform.
I think she will perform. I think, you know, don't even look at the start. I told her, just get safely out of the sound and then see what you can do. And she knows all the tricks. She knows how to sail a boat well and fast. And it's really mainly, will she handle the big stuff?
That's her. Sorry for interrupting you. I believe that sign there. No, that's a man. It's not, definitely not her. Now, we're looking for a dark gray Seascape 18. That's not her. We'll find her. She'll be in the picture in just a minute. Yeah. This is the Estonian Proto Mini.
Yeah.
Beautiful with, like I said, the skull bow. And that's definitely going to be a contender at this race. A lot of sail, a lot of power. Look at the size of that huge Jenica.
Yeah.
Look at the speed that that's doing already. And note the way that he's reaching a lot tighter to the wind on the opposite tack than the other boats. It looks like he's just about to jive there. There you go.
Yeah.
Lovely picture. Thank you, Fleming. He's just jiving there at the point. It's a long way around. He's probably just discovered there's not much water over there. You don't want to get too close to shore.
It looks like a nice start to get into the rhythm.
Yeah, we're just panning a little bit around here. A little bit further to the right, please, Fleming. There you go, that one there, one of the purple. That's the other. Actually, that, the boss dig, that is Anders Best Jansen.
Okay.
With two reefs in the main. That's surprising. I thought that was Anders at the front of the fleet there. Interesting. He's got a figure of eight on his Jenica there.
Yeah.
Let's give him a break and let him sail. But I'm surprised that he's got two reefs in his main at this stage of the race.
Maybe they were just too afraid of some of the gusts hitting.
Yeah. There's Sunny there in the Jenica.
Yes.
Yeah. She's very, very late on the start.
I'd like to welcome Anders Michelin, who's just arrived. Thanks for joining us, Anders.
Hello, good morning.
Anders is the CEO of First Seascape. I should probably call it First. I've got to be careful. I was told off yesterday for calling it.
It's okay. It's basically it's a first and it's a Seascape edition. So we keep both brands. We are greedy.
It's great to have you here and at the event again. And you guys have just been such a large part of the Silverrudder community, and it's great to have you sort of officially on board. And right in the middle of the picture is your what could I call her?
Well, guest.
Your guest, yeah. Sunny Boyke in her Seascape 18.
I guess you can say brand ambassador.
Brand ambassador.
Well, that would be ambitious, I think. You know, we wish. Yeah. But yeah, I think she, you know, she's making such a huge leap, you know, from Olympic to, this is probably as far as you can go in terms of sailing experience, you know, going from windward leeward high performance skiffs to a tiny offshore going. So I think the only thing similar is that both boats are performance boats.
Yeah.
And interesting as well, as you saw, is that the boats that have very simple setups, like Melgus, do really well because they don't have choices. So you just put the Jenica up or not.
Yeah.
So they're going to have more problems going up after you turn around.
Certainly.
And we have second French person with the red Jenica, who's all the way in the front with the Seascape 24.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Henrik, you know, who won, I think, most of the editions on his
T24. Yeah, sure. Patrick Heinrich. Patrick. We've been talking about him. He's definitely a contender for the
win. I think he's the man to beat, for sure.
Well, we mustn't forget. We see 124 with the fur Jennifer.
Oh, there in the shallows.
Is this Emmerich?
There's a grounding of
It could be. It could be.
He needs to free himself from this. It looks like he's getting off easily.
It's a good
example. 24. That's a grounded seascape 24.
Luckily,
he's coming free there. But there are actually some really, really wicked rocks over there. You've got to be very careful.
Lucky he has a lifting keel, so that was easy.
He might need it.
Oh yeah, everybody's
free because just on that corner there are some big rocks.
The problem with our boats is that they all have lifting keels with a winch, so people are a little bit too relaxed, I think, going shallow because they know they can get off.
Sure. Yeah.
And it's amazing to think, you know, you have 18s which are going into these conditions. There is one owner who decided to stay on shore, which I think was very smart. Because on the 18, every year is just a challenge to finish. I think 18s are these ultimate challengers.
I think so. The 18 and the CB66 that Jörg and I were just talking about.
Yes, exactly.
He's actually gone far to the left compared to the rest of the fleet. Yeah. Surprising, but don't. He knows what he's doing. He's raced through here days and nights in all kinds of different classes, so don't underestimate him. He's going to go and try and find a little bit of leap in the current.
Exactly.
And he'll sneak it on the side
there. Yeah.
He knows what he's doing. And he knows he goes on a much higher reach once he goes further to the left on the east side of the boys there.
So I think
he will not be as sheltered from the forest, so
that's
there's
right.
another positive side to being left.
There's a rule here.
But he's
every time you go through it, regardless of the wind direction, you always stay on the turbo side.
Right.
Yeah. Which not one of them are doing over there. You'll see why in just a second. Because when they come to the next headland, there'll be no wind at all.
Yes.
So
yeah, well, you can see it underwater, actually.
Yeah, of course you can.
And
I'm surprised that more of them have been out training and finding that tendency here. Yeah.
But I think these classes, you know, when you look at all of those boats here, there is very, instead of the minis, which are the only real ocean-going boats, all the rest are inshore boats. So I think pretty much everyone on this class is, for me, I won't say a hero is a big word, but they're definitely very brave. So they go against their fear. They're all afraid a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Let's say, as you usually pointed out, they go far outside their comfort zone.
Yeah, exactly. I think because you have to have fear to be brave. You know, you cannot be brave without fear. So these guys are definitely the bravest, in my opinion.
I agree with you. We all and I were in fact just talking about a few minutes ago that racing around Foon in these conditions in a 40-foot boat is, you know, yeah, it's good, and you're probably going to know that you've been out there. But doing it in a Seascape 18 or a CB66 is...
Or a Sessi Sailart 19, you know, and boats like the Etap 21.
Sure,
so.
Sure.
So, yeah, I think each of those guys that finishes is going to really earn their finisher T-shirt.
Probably worth mentioning a female sailor which is in the race, and that's her right in the picture there, I believe. That's Gru Clock Thompson. Gru got a wild card 84 days ago and didn't have a boat at the time.
Wow.
So she bought this and has never owned a boat before.
Oh, she bought a boat. So
she bought a boat because we gave her a wild card.
That's a
and she said, I'm going to do this. I mean, she's no normal cookie. She's climbed the Kilimanjaro and doesn't matter, has done a marathon. But she's not a sailor by birth. She sailed with her family, but it hasn't raced. And she's been really cool. Got sponsors. Got a motor sponsored. Got all kinds of electronics sponsored. She's a gem, and you know has set up a website. And I'm really excited to see her here. And she's a real inspiration for other women that might like to join the race.
I agree. I think it's. It's interesting that in Vendée Globe, percentage of the women in the race is way higher than on Silverrudder.
And this has got to be easier.
it's because I think because most people come unprepared, it's actually arguable.
You say that people don't come as prepared. You say.
No, that's the thing. You know, Vendée Globe is your life project, so
it's
way harder. But a lot of these people I know from owners we have. They have normal jobs and they can come very late.
Sure.
You know, Sani, you talked about Sani, Suzanne Boyke before, and you know, she just came from Killer Volcano, got a boat. It's a
look,
borrowed boat.
A week ago, you and I talked about it. She didn't know she was coming.
Yeah, so exactly. So actually, you were kind enough to give her a wild card. and I think that's the trick of this kind of race. It's one part. I mean, she's probably the best sailor technically on the race, but.
Sure.
But, you know, doing this kind of sailing, it's not just technical part.
Because one thing is technical trimming of a sail, and the other is local tactics. I mean, being able to have the countercurrents and the ebbs and the...
But even that, you know, my experience with these top sailors is that they're just elite sailors.
Yeah.
They figure it out. You know, I
sure they do.
Even if they go from hatch race to offshore, in an instant they're going to figure it out
they
and going to be super fast.
Yeah.
It's more about whether the equipment is going to hold, you know. She has a borrowed boat.
Sure.
You know,
it's
things can break.
And the boat's untested. It's not a boat we've seen on the circuit here at all.
No. So, and it's going to be about 25 knots in parts of the race.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that will be her challenge.
We just saw the drone footage, and it looked like the CB66 was, if not in front, but she was amongst the top three boats.
Was he? Yeah, Klaus.
And also Patrick Heinrichs.
Yeah, we can see him out there in his black sails there.
Yeah.
And look at the angle that he's going. He's going much higher to the rest compared to the rest of the boats. He's definitely attacking. You know, he's going for speed instead of just cruising well to windward. You see the other boats going much deeper to windward, whereas Patrick is sort of going at an angle of about 30 degrees to the rest of the boats.
And we still have some boats crossing the line.
Yes,
moment.
Boats haven't started yet.
The next class is already sort of warming up. We still have
There is a
canter over the line just now.
And we have
some
first 20 and
And
it's a counter current and it's always tricky.
Sure, there's an Alban Express there. That's in the next start. That's in the
small
start.
Is it the next one?
And so is the Spearcocker down there. Yeah, this looks like the last boat, the boat that's in the picture now.
So everybody successfully started. So
yeah,
that's
it looks like that. 055. We'll just look to check out the number. Yeah.
So you see that Emmerich, so the French guy, figured out very quickly that left side is better. So it's going all the way left to the CB66.
Well.
So that's what I'm saying about this elite sailor.
Sure.
He won the Tour de France Savoie.
Yeah.
Which is basically like this. It's a long coastal race,
and
they don't need a lot of time.
No,
to figure
there are
it
no
out.
Surprises for these guys. They can pick it up.
They ground on one time, and then you know.
Maybe there's also shallows on the other side.
Maybe he'll just go.
if you go too close,
touch and go.
I mean, if you go too close to the little red hut down there behind Dali, then you'll go ground as well. But I think their keels are sufficiently shallow that they'll come. I'll go over the top of that.
Well, the 24 has 2 meters draft, you know, so it's pretty deep.
Does it?
Yeah, but you can lift it to 30 centimeters. So so it's all tempting thing, you know. Some people actually would go and half lift the keel. And
but now that he's sort of on a leash, or he should not really risk of...
No.
It's going to be harder. To
he's
going to
be very close to the shoals there. But and Klaus with the CB66, which is to the left of him, you know, on Delhi's port side. And they're going to both be very close to the shore there.
So here you can see on the start, looking at the footage, that in these kind of conditions, it's not a big difference between big and small boats, because it's all about where you are and how actively you trim the boat. And so we are used to have 18s, you know, messing things around for a long time in the front, even though they're tiny. But then eventually, obviously, the water length prevails, and the 24 footers would go ahead.
Yeah, and the small boats are so much more mobile in these relatively confined conditions.
Exactly.
They can, like you say, they can jibe from side to side without needing too much space.
So Andras, you have done this race six times. Look at the fleet just going outside of Toure, towards Toure. What goes on in the minds of the skippers when they are on a long leg like this, and they prepare to do a jibe and another jibe, and then sort of facing the more offshore part?
I think it's a very tricky one, because you know it's pretty stiff conditions outside, pretty stiff conditions once you get out of the fjord. And as you can see, some people put two reefs, some people put one reef. And what goes through your head is like, was that a good idea? Because you're suffering a lot.
Yeah.
But then, you know, inevitably, once you get out, you are rewarded for that, because you don't lose time. So you have to be very, very physically fit and aggressive sailor, like, for example, Patrick or guys like that, to pull it off and really always go for 100%. So this is pretty much, you know, responding to things. Even you had the tactics here, you just respond to where the crowd is, and, you know, you see gusts on the water and you go a bit more left, a bit more right. But once they will exit the fjord in like an hour or something, it's going to be where the grinding starts, you know, where you where you have to really work it, and it's going to be big differences between the guys and girls that are really working it and the guys who are just, you know, sitting there
cruising it.
Yeah,
they just set the sails and they're trimming the mainsail a little bit, but the rest is just letting the boat do the work.
Exactly. Yeah. We said on a skipper's briefing that they should write, you know, what advice was, they should write with big letters on their bulkheads, trim question mark, because what you do in this kind of long race is you get complacent and you know you're just sitting on the and it feels good and you're a little bit, you know, hold and you don't want to move. So the guys who are actually actively trimming the boat and the girls and those who are, again, not really cruising, you're in racing mode, but you're just a bit more lazy, you make huge differences.
I mean, the course races that are used to, you know, marking optimal wind direction and marking target speeds and setting in a new target speed. I've just like 10 centimeters on my sheets, new target speed 6.4. I think those guys are the ones that are constantly performing as opposed to the perhaps the more cruising.
Yeah, we will see on a tracker very quickly the difference between one and the other, I think. Yeah, yeah. Even they're on the same boats, because we have a lot of similar boats. We have how many, like few male, just 24s, then 18s, the Seascape first SE 24s. So we have a lot of these groups, and you will be amazed to see what difference does it make on equal boats. So everybody who thinks investing a lot of money in equipment, I think that's a good lesson on where the time and energy should go.
You're right. Hours on the water. That's the
investment the you're looking results. For. Yeah. If you can buy hours on the water, you know, then that's the investment you're looking for.
Yeah. Andreas, this is going to be a tough upwind leg up to the northeast corner of Fyn, and then there is a sort of a a blast reach, which will be fun, but then you will be a bit tired, and your focus will shift. It's a totally different game going downwind, maybe with the Jennaker into the night or in the night. So where would you rest in this first half of the race?
So there is one opportunity, which is going to be when the axis of the through goes over the fleet. So it's going to be probably around the Big Belt Bridge, where the wind is going to go north and it should drop a little bit. So I think, and it also is going to be upwind in that part. So that's a good place where you could probably get a little bit of snack, you know, some snacks. But there's not going to be real resting. I think that's the problem for small boats. You're going to go all the way up, you're going to be very, very tired, and then is the night, and then is the power reach. And the bigger boats, even the next class, the small class, they're going to have the time of their life. You know, these are the kill boats, you know, the next class are the kill boats. The 27s will put their reaching sails up. They're going to, we at the moment, routing is showing 3 hours between head of fin to little bells.
So doing 15, 16 knots.
Average 14 knots, you know, in the top. So, but it's not so much for the small boats. I think for small boats, even reaching is going to be just fight.
There's going to be some waves up there, and they risk nose diving. They're going to have
exactly. The Melges 24 is going to be. That's going to be. These guys are going to suffer. They're not having a lot of stability.
They might not need their Jennakers at all.
Oh no, no Jennakers. I think it's more a question. You know, do you keep the main or you take it off? Or you know, I think it's going to be a real fight. And so yeah, keep there. I mean, I think you should have your hearts out for the mini class. These guys are going to, except the mini transat. These guys are going to be cruising. You know.
Yeah. Gentlemen, thanks very much. I'm going to ask you to come back to me in just a few minutes. I've got Jan Müller here, round the world sailor from Denmark, here, that's offered to come and have a chat with us. So
and he's competing as well.
He is just indeed.
He's taking a short break.
He's rolled out to have a chat with us, and he's going back. He's out racing in 2.5 hours' time. Jan, would you like to come and talk to us? And told coming.
I thought you were on the race.
You got it.
Yeah.
Right up close there, guys. Next to me is Troels Lykke from Min Båd.
Hello. Here we are
and,
again.
Between us is Jan Müller. Welcome on the stage. We're standing on wet grass under a tree, right on the starting line of the Silverrudder. Jan, welcome. I'm pleased you could come and make it. I mean, you're racing in 2 hours' time. What are you doing here?
Yeah, exactly. I don't have much time, but I'm really excited about the race this year. I was asked the other day how many Silverrudders I've done. I say, I don't know, but I know the three I haven't done. They are painful to me. And there's one where I have abandoned the race. That's even more painful. So I promise you this year, one, I will start, and two, I will do everything I can do to finish.
But which boat are you sailing in, Jan?
My wife and I purchased a new boat, a new old boat, a 49-foot IRC boat, very, very nice carbon fiber, middle sea, comfortable rocket. So we are having fun with that boat, and it's we did a little bit of cruising around Zealand in the Round Zealand race with fully crewed. Now this is my very first, I say very first single hand race on this one.
Yeah, and how many sails do you bring on your boat?
I don't bring that many. It's I basically have five sails to work on.
Yeah,
and there's two jibs, an all round and a light, which we've been working on, and a Code Zero and a Janaga.
And will you put out the Janaga?
Do you got
the balls for that, Jan?
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I can tell you when we're done with the race. Whether at Fynsud, it looks like marginal conditions for me, a very tight angle and up to 20 knots, and the waves are notorious in that corner. So whether I will be able to convince myself to put the Kajenang up, because I have a lee shore, and you have to consider things going wrong, and so that's and I might consort with the Code Zero, which is a
but do big you have a limit, wind limit?
I'm feeling my way through it, because I don't know that boat, the boat, that well. I know it's laid out for the Mediterranean, and that means that there's a huge amount of sail on. Imagine the mainsail alone is 85 square meters.
Yeah. So how deep is your keel?
Nearly 3 meters.
Oh, 2 meters. So you have to sail a longer way than the other guys.
Higher mast and deeper keel. Yeah, that is not a benefit in this race.
No. And how long time will you use for this? I mean,
I saw the record was 19 hours. Timing I have. If we can make 19 hours and 9 minutes, that would be fantastic. I don't think so, but. Around 20 to 22 hours, I would say, it would take.
Yeah, and what about sailing around? Will you sleep?
That's doubtful. I think I will have a very short nap or two. In my old boat, where it was so much slower.
The Aphrodite.
The Aphrodite 101. It was a great boat to sail this race with, and it's there I could afford myself a 20-minute nap occasionally. But it's something you pre-plan, and you say, okay, this part of the trip, on the northern parts of Funen, you might be able to sleep, but it's not really in the cards this year.
Yeah, your sail, sir, what is that?
Yeah, well, that's our new gadget, and it's so exciting. It's basically an automatic logbook that allows all your boat data to be transferred to the cloud, and for your friends and family to follow you, and it's a it does everything that you would like to do, like keeping a log and understanding what's happening on board.
But we can feel you, see you on track. So is
the track and the AIS, they're great tools, and they tell you what you see from the outside and your course and speed. But Sail Server also allows you to see wind speed, wind direction, the heel of the boat, the pitch of the boat, everything that your instrument network is telling you is recorded to the Sail Server and being uploaded to the cloud. So it's a great product that we are putting to the market now.
And you are a boss from Lupulite, and you are interested in this Sail Server. Why?
Yeah. I spent 90% of my time with Lupulite and enjoying it tremendously. We have great success, but Sail Server is developed by a close old friend of mine that was in need of a bit of sail support, and I think I can provide that, and so we've joined forces simply.
Okay, and I think we have to finish now. We have a new start. My boss Philip Kostner is saying
we see the countdown. Yeah.
But what time will you start?
At 12 o'clock.
Okay, we would see what you're doing.
Okay, thanks. I hope to make a good start.
Thank you, guys.
Jan, thanks for coming and talking to us. Have a great race. Thanks a lot to Jan, and we'd love to hear a lot more about Sail Server at a later stage. Yeah. 6 minutes to the next start. That was the 5-minute signal for the next start. That's why I thought I had to perhaps just butt in. I'm sorry about that.
No.
And I hear rumors from the harbor in Svendborg that we're having trouble undocking some of the medium and large boats because of the the blocked up harbor, but if you have a look at the boat in front of us there, Fleming, the Blue 30, gorgeous looking boat, definitely a contender for the win in this class. This is the small class you see here, that's boats just less than 30 feet, 4.5 minutes to go, tolls. Yeah. What do you think?
The current is against them, so it's not so good, but they have wind this year. So I just talked with a German reporter, and she loves that wind here. She has been here before where there was no wind. So
yeah, this is a great change compared to last year. I mean, last year was tough going for the sailors. I mean, this is going to be tough because there's wind, and as you leave the reef at Touro, that was the 4 minute signal, reef at Touro, they're going to generate a lot more wind, which could be a concern to some of the boats. But this class of boats, at least the racers amongst them, are going to be flying. Who do you think is a contender for the win here?
It must be the very light boats here. I can see some Seascape 24 here from my position.
I mean, we mustn't forget that the Seascape 27's here. This is the start of the European Championship, the official Eurosaf European Championships. And amongst these boats as well, you've got the X79, so we're here for the honour of winning the fantastic Elfstrom and Exiotsk Spinnaker that's being awarded to the winner. So there are two races within the race here. And I'm just going to go get Andras Mihailin back to us in for a second, where we'll talk about who's in the running for the win in the Seascape 27. Okay, we're back again, Han. Look at the starting line. The boat you can see right in front of his spiff is Sierkaline, who is an instructor at the local sailing college here, Or. And this is her first silver rudder. She's sailing her dad's X79. She's a contender for the win. Andras, fantastic race, because this is the race within the race. And you've got a Seascape 27 Euroscape Euro SAF Championship. What do you think?
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it? I think it was a bit of a surprise to our owners. We could organize it because they just signed in for a very relaxed Silverrudder race with not so many rules.
Yeah.
So we are really happy they took it with enthusiasm, and I think that is as we spoke, it's a bit of an experiment to see whether we could keep the relaxedness of Silverrudder, but still give people some sort of a class racing thing where they can hope to win a prize even if they are not the biggest boat or the most radical boat or something like that. I mean, like you do with the X79s, sort of.
I can imagine it was sort of a bit of a surprise to some of them, a good surprise. You know, they've enrolled on a race and loads of different nationalities, Swedes, and there's a Czech and a Slovenian, there's a Swiss guy. You know,
yeah.
And suddenly they found themselves contenders for the
With a flag on their sail.
Yeah, I mean, you guys have done a great job. You know, first have done a great job getting this setup lined up. I mean, you've only had 2 weeks to get all the details.
Yeah, our team was really good. I just have best words for the team we have here at Seascape. You know, working on first.
We've had a great cooperation with them as well. I mean, you guys have been really, really good, and it's great to have you back as such a huge part of the Silverrudder DNA. It's a pleasure to have you here every single year.
Yeah, I mean, it was a cooperation, as you said, you know. So it was work on your end, you know. So you pushed it in, and okay. So we are what? We are a minute to start.
That's the 1 minute to start. We've got 1 minute, and look at, once again, you see very, very conservative start. People lay well off the line. You've got an L28 here, as you can see, Shamu furthest on the right.
Oh wow! The grand piano on the water.
Yeah, and you've got this beautiful boat that's coming into the camera now. Unfortunately, there's some trees there. If you just hold the camera there a second, Fleming. Or pan to the right a bit more, as far as you can go.
Yeah, here we go.
This is Dirk Manoff from UK Sales in Flensburg in his beautiful
varnished wood.
LA28.
Yeah, the violins would be embarrassed by the quality of that wood.
You're right. I mean, it's an absolutely fantastic boat. It's gorgeous, like you say. It looks like a piece of furniture. And this is, I think, Dirk's third attempt. I'm not sure. Oh, I have to be careful what I'm saying. I'm not sure if he's completed the Silverrudder.
Oh, he's going all the way.
Really,
look at
really
that.
Motivated this
Masthead, Masthead Jenniker.
Masthead Jenniker. He's a sailmaker, like
okay.
I said, UK Sales.
So
he knows what he's doing.
So we have a Blue 26.
Is it
30? Okay, yeah. So that's a fast boat.
Just slightly below the 30-foot mark. Very fast boat, yeah.
But it's a much more aggressive start maybe than on the mini start.
Yeah, much more.
But everybody on, most of the guys on masthead sails, and
who's that we've got further? So the Swedish guys had Ben. But let me see who that is we've got.
So it's either Bert or is Martin. I don't see the. So we see the
there's
German.
There's a Swedish first 27 furthest to windward there, but there's not going to be as much wind to windward. This we're
no, exactly. Manners, yeah? As we said, we saw on the mini class, keeping left actually pays off. So way in the front of us, there is a heartbeat with the only female skipper, I think, in the class.
That's Marlene.
Yeah, Marlene.
And she used to have a Sunbeam 22 and has definitely upgraded to this beautiful first 27.
Yeah, just in time and she's to join.
Yeah. And she raced in another 27 SC at the Vegvisir a couple of weeks ago.
She did.
Yeah, she did indeed. So she's quite prepared.
So actually the 27 we saw starting first is Bert Forsberg. Mm-hmm. He's a super fast sailor.
Swedish guy. Yeah.
Swedish guy. Mm-hmm. And Avanti on the left, I think, it's going to be too slow with that furling coat sail.
I
think with these boats, which are a little bit heavier, I think the guys who went for a big Jennikers, we see some of them, they're going to do much better.
I'm surprised. I mean, the shortest distance is definitely furthest to the right, no doubt about it, you know.
But it's hard to get out of it, isn't it?
There.
Yes, exactly.
Whereas if you look at this boat that's coming into the picture now, if you go slide to the right, Fleming, just ever so slightly, there's an Alban Express Numero Uno, who's an East German
With the
guy
I've raced Orange Jenniker?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. You know, he's slowed down a bit, he's lost some wind in his Jenniker. But he was screeching along like this, the OD30 that's coming into the picture here as well.
Yeah, the Deller, also
I'm
with a reaching sail.
Aren't you surprised that they're not, you know, closer up to the line? I mean, those guys are racing machines. Most of the skippers on the
I think it's a very complicated boat, so I think with the Deller you want to play it a little bit safer. They have running backstays and stuff like that. So, but they're on the good side. I think they're going to be quick. Yeah. And you see on the right side, well, on the far end of the screen, how on a downwind start you have a big problem of the wind shadows of the boat behind you. So it doesn't really help you to be in front if you don't have a clear wind behind you.
You need free air, that's right. That's the whole secret of this race. At least the start, the first half an hour.
And also you see that it's a real downwind. So all the boats on the right hand of the start line are now sucked into the right end.
Completely vacuumed, there's no wind.
They'll have to jibe at one point, and it's going to be very tricky to cross the fleet.
Well, yeah, that's right, it'll be very tricky. Not only that they will have to jibe, they'll go into a port tack or a port jibe, which means that they're going to have to give way to all the boats that are coming on the starboard. Remember,
exactly.
This race is raced entirely on the collision avoidance rules.
Yes, you know, even the European Championship is raced on collision avoidance rules, which was also a big operation for Eurosaf to allow us to do that.
Sure, I can imagine that. Well, it's unconventional, isn't it?
I think it never happened before.
No,
I think it's the first time. Yeah. It's the first single-handed European Championship on one design boats ever, and it's on coal racks.
And well, we've been asked, you know, what are the arguments for that? What's the reason for doing that? Well, amongst other things, can you imagine if you had to have boats being luffed against each other? Oh, look, first boat to jibe on the other side there.
Yeah,
can you imagine
trying
boats
to get out
aggressively towards each other in the night, you know, after these guys haven't slept for 36 hours?
No, exactly. And so the 27 with the blue Jenniker is Philipp Lenzlinger. I think it's his fourth Silverrudder, so he's super experienced guy.
With the green Jenniker.
Yeah, yeah. From Switzerland.
Yeah.
So he did a very conservative start, but he's going to be he's going to catch up super quickly when they get out.
And you can see the fleet is just moving out slightly.
So we move to this pack of boats under the trees. They will all try to get to the left side at one point. You see the Dellers that were really late, but further to the left, how they pushed forward.
That's right. The first one who's flying a code zero there is already going really fast compared to the majority of the boats further to windward.
Exactly.
Under the trees there.
And you know, the Albin Express, which is objectively a much slower boat, you know, doing good job, doing just
really
going
well.
The right place.
Well, that boat surprises every time. And so, I mean, it has a bit of a problem planing, but...
it doesn't plane, but it's very efficient.
Beating and, you know, and reaching, it's a fantastic
I learned
boat.
To sail on that boat. My father had it, yeah. It's an amazing boat, super seaworthy.
You know, I've raced one with the same four crewmen for 20 years. We actually won the Danish National Championships
this
year. Oh,
wow. Yeah, we were never that good.
And
we
I
just
had one as well. I used to have one way back, so it's a fantastic boat.
Okay, great shots from the top. We see the Grand Piano is doing extremely well.
Yeah, gorgeous boat.
And there is the L30, I guess, the B30 next to it.
And there's our new partner in the X Power 33 there, the Red Power.
Oh yeah, the comfy. Yeah, the very comfy boats they have supplied.
And he's got a load of the pro skippers that help us out in the safety checks, and they're the kids that are going to be monitoring the race throughout the race. In the
That's great. I think we need more brands supporting their owners, and that's going to, you know, bring more owners, and they're going to sell better, and it's going to have more fun.
Yeah, well, I mean, we can definitely tell we've been contacted by more and more people that are interested in the event, you know, which is nice.
Yeah. Because what we want is, you know, we want to have people that come, that have, you know, they learn something, they go out of their comfort zone, but not out of their safety zone. I think
just the atmosphere, and you know, people are writing to us saying, you know, say hi to this guy, I can't come this year, but please go and send my, you know, my regards to this and this guy in this boat. I mean, the community that's
excellent.
Risen here is fantastic. I got a message from Stefan Foss, who normally races the Aschambault 35 in the medium class against Pierre Svanberg, who broke his
boat here on the Vegvisir.
And he says, oh, my condolences, because he can't race. Yeah. Lovely.
Well, actually, Per Sederberg is on this race.
Not Per Sederberg. Oh, Per Svanberg.
Per Svanberg, sorry.
Far East 31, who was on stage last night.
Right.
Who's going to be racing the Vegvisir with me next year.
Ah, okay. Yeah. You're fixed on that.
Well, Morten Brandt here gave us a wild card, and I'm up for the challenge. With Per on my side, I'm in good hands.
It's such a great development that, you know, the it's a positive rivalry between the races.
Sure. There's no reason in axing each other. You know, there's
excellent.
Plenty of water out there, plenty of boats out there. I'm sure we can do a great job together. So I'm really pleased, Morten. If you're listening in, thanks for coming in and spending some of your precious time.
I think a lot of people were so happy to see that.
Yeah, it made a lot of people happy. Good to see you hands with all the years today.
So, looking back to the field, we see that, you know,
I mean, just sorry taking up the speak at the moment.
Sure.
I mean, we're about 10 minutes since the start went, and there's a Dela 30 OD which hasn't even crossed the starting line yet.
Yeah, just with the jib.
And quite honestly, it's going to hurt now, but in about an hour's time, the chances are, if he sails and plays the game cleverly, then he might not even notice that he started. You know,
no. Well, you have to know the Dela 30s have water ballast. So
that's
for
right.
this
yeah.
race, they're perfectly equipped. I would be super surprised if a Dela 30 doesn't win this race.
Really?
Oh, yeah. This is... I think it's going to be Dela 30s and Seascape 27s.
Mm-hmm. They're going to battle it out.
Yeah, everybody else is going to have a hard time keeping up. So any 27 that beats any Dela 30, it's going to do a great job. And any other boat that beats any of the two will do an amazing job. Because all the other boats are more inshore boats.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a race where you need a lot of stability.
Yes.
So I think this start is a bit deceiving on who's gonna end up where, because once you get out on the wind and on the waves,
I mean, you've got some fast boats amongst the X79s, and there are a couple of very very experienced sailors, and in the right hands that boat can be a monster, but I think perhaps we're just slightly in the top of its capability.
Just I think on all the way going up, you know, they can be quite competitive in these tight angles, but when you have a power reaching in the night, there's going to be a huge difference.
Sure. I mean, some of the good guys will set their spinnakers and they'll plane at 10, 11 knots, but there's a 5, 6 knot with the speed difference between
it will be
a so first 27. I'm just being told that we're going to move on to some pictures from the first start, the minis. We've got a drone flying out there on the other side of the sound. These are still from the...
So Sunbeam. So this
is the Sunbeam 20.
Sunbeam chased by a first 24 SE.
Yeah.
And there is a mini in the background. You can see the length
great
of the bowsprit of a mini. So
yeah.
It's 3.5 meters. So the boat is 6.5 meters long. 3.5 meter bowsprit.
Incredible. And the combinations of sails and stuff that those guys have said is absolutely amazing.
And I think what is shown so well on this race is, for example, you have boats like 18 or Amelges, which just have three sails, you know, main, jib, and Jennaker.
Totally.
And they are so efficient using them because their brain is not thinking all the time, should I put a coat
you know?
Or should I put a mask? Should I put a fractional? And you can see here that on this start, that for example, you know, you see the 24 here with coat sail. Which would probably just, if you wouldn't have an option of putting that sail, it would put up Jennaker.
Sure you would. Yeah, sure, if it was an option. The Marlene Brudek in the first 2070, she said, one of the nicer things about getting a one design boat is that I don't have to constantly use my imagination on how to optimize the boat.
Yeah,
boat is top-optimized. There's a fixed menu of what sails I can carry and off, and that's it.
That's an interesting boat. That's a 419 Mini. All the Minis have numbers,
and
I know this is a boat I raced against in 2007 Mini Transat. It was sailed by Phil Sharp,
mm-hmm.
who also was on Silverrudder and didn't do the race. It was too windy that
year. I remember
year.
He was going to race a seascape.
But this is a very, very fast boat, super well prepared by Henry Kors.
What do you think of his sail plan, that he's got a reef in the main and looks like what is a relatively small Jennica?
That's good, because you have to know this boat weighs like 800 kilos.
Nothing.
And it's carrying, right now it's carrying, well, let's forget the jib, but just the Jennica in the main is about 80 square meters,
yeah,
90 square meters.
Huge, huge Jennica.
So normally if you would go for full sails, that would be about 100 plus square meters of sails. Mm. So he doesn't need that.
For a 6.5 meter long boat.
6.5 meter, 800 kilo boat.
24 feet, yeah.
So it has a canton keel, it has water ballast. It's a super complicated boat, and that's going to be a challenge for Henrik.
Yeah.
Because I had a boat like that, and it took me 2 years and a full 200 days on the water to actually learn how to use it.
Really?
It's super complicated. To sail it fast.
Yeah. Why is that particular boat so much more difficult to trim or to learn? To trim optimally.
It was basically what we talked before. It has so many options,
yeah,
and you have to pick the right ones all the time.
Okay.
When you have a simple boat, you have less options, so the absolute potential is lower,
mm-hmm,
but you sail it more efficiently. Mm-hmm. So it's great to have this boat back.
I'd like you, Fleming, if you could, to move the camera as far to the right. Oh, you want drone pictures? Don't worry, we'll wait.
It's still the mini start.
Yeah.
So you see, we have three sets. Typically, you would have people who just use the jib very conservatively. Then you would have people with furling sails, furling spinnakers, which I think is a good option for most. And then the most ambitious one with proper downwind spinnakers.
Yeah, with A2s.
With yeah. A2s, yeah. And that's for guys who are a little bit more, and girls who are a little bit more confident. Because
sure.
It is a bit of an effort to take it
and
on.
It's a lot of sail. Yeah,
it's a lot of sails. And also, if you end up in a crowd, it's you have less options to maneuver.
Yeah, you just don't have the same option to be able to come further up.
To laugh up or
you
to...
Don't. That's right, yeah. So what are the normal sail the angles of an A2, you know, very deep Jennica?
Well, normally there is a counter current, so it's a bit funny for everybody. I think it's counterintuitive, but normally in these kind of conditions you would just basically soak it. You would go 150 through. So that's what we're talking before. So uh-huh. You know, a 24, it's an extremely powerful boat. It has sail area displacement. It's like on a mini transat,
yeah.
But it has less stability, of course.
Sure, it doesn't have the water ballast.
Doesn't
it
have the water. The hull is not
heel.
That. It's just 2.5 meters wide.
Yeah,
mini
yeah.
is 3 meters
so it
wide.
It doesn't have the same form stability
exactly.
at all. Of course not.
So, but yeah, look. Every time I'm looking at the 18s, you know, these guys are. I mean, I think everyone who, they don't care when they finish. When they finish, I think they're the happiest people in the 400 boat fleet.
On the fleet, yeah, yeah.
I was one of those in 2012.
Oh, it's a tough boat to sail, isn't it? In these conditions.
But it's so rewarding. I always.
What makes the first 18 SE so rewarding? What is it about? I mean, it's a small boat. What makes it such a pleasure to sail?
Well, I think it's. I always preach you should always get yourself the smallest boat you can get that you feel still safe on.
Until your wife gets involved.
No, because it's two things. If you're buying a racer cruiser, it's a tricky
sure,
part.
Sure.
Because with a cruiser, it's always the volume. Every boat is small, so you know the comfort starts at 40 feet, really.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a different. But when you're looking for a sailing boat for sailing, the smallest you can get your hands on, the better
agree.
Sailing is going
to
have.
Sure, the better the sailing experience, the more the fun, the cheaper it is to maintain and keep up.
Exactly.
Today, you know?
So you have to know the 18 guys come with their trailers. They'll throw the boat in the water
yeah.
after the race, put it back on. You know, like next day they're back home
great,
with
yeah.
their boat.
No,
on the
I entirely agree. I often find myself on boats with a 10-man crew, and when I go back to the little Alban Express or you know tiny little boats,
it is rewarding, isn't it?
You know, you can just whip down the spinnaker and whip it up, and you can move the boat. You can feel it moving in a completely different manner than a heavy boat. Yeah.
So that's what I suggest to anyone listening. Mm. I think get yourself the smallest boat you feel safe on. I think that's the thing. So that's the thing. And then, of course, if boat is fun to sail, it's so much the better. But
yeah, it's lively, and you can actually see when you move, you can feel it when you move from one side to the boat to the other.
Oh, yeah.
Things actually happen.
And accelerations, and you're so close to the sea.
And
you're connected with the sea. So you have to know, on 18s, lots of people don't have autopilots, which is by itself extremely hard. So once you don't have an autopilot, it means that you're connected with the boat.
Don't any of the Seascape 18s?
Some do, but it's very, even they have it, it doesn't work really well.
They just can't react fast enough.
So that's, I think, the main thing. You know, you connect with your boat through the tiller, and you're connected for 30 hours.
Let me just talk about this boat that we can see in the picture now. This is Michael.
Oh, the pirate?
I want to give Michael a big embrazo, as I say in Spanish, it's a big hug. He's taken his boat on a trailer, on a truck all the way from Austria. It's a Sunbeam 26 called Robbie. He's got the skull and crossbones on his on his mainsail. He even gives out skull and crossbones caps to people who come visit his boat.
He has a brand.
And he's got Austrian wine with him. He's a lovely guy. You know, Michael, you are what the Silverrudder is made of. Your keel, I think, is about 60 centimeters deep.
You're going to shallow keel.
You're going to get the shit beaten out of you when you leave Svendborg Sound, but we're proud of you. We hope you make it all the way around. And we look
so he's from Noisy-le-Zee,
yeah, exactly.
Where there is no water there.
A couple of times he's put the boat on a truck and taken it to Croatia, where he cruises with his family and then back onto the lake again. I mean,
that
is really, well, that is what the DNA of the Silverrudder is all about. So we remember to talk about this guy and the Maxi Phoenix behind him and not just the rockets that have just started. Fleming, perhaps you could pan further to the right so we can see some of the beautiful boats that are coming to the race now.
Sunfast 3300.
That's a JPK 10-8 or 10-30 there.
Yeah.
Lightworks, and we've got the Figaro 2 with the Anne Hansen on it.
Yeah. Is that the JPK 10-30?
That's JPK, yeah. And that's definitely contender. He raced the big VC 2 weeks ago and did very well. Unfortunately, the record holder in the 10-30. Andreas Rode has had to cancel his participation in the Silverrudder this year because he has damaged his boat, which we're really, really sorry about.
So I think we're going to move to the expert for the was that medium class?
Why am I the expert for the medium class?
Because you own the J109.
Yes, but now I own a very small 24 boat.
I'm not sure if the microphone is still on. Joachim, welcome back. Good to have you back here.
Philip.
Thank you very much, Andrew.
I was introduced to being a medium class expert.
Brilliant.
So I hope I fulfill that role.
I certainly asked you to come back here for the medium class because I know that you've got a few words to say about some of the boats. I mean, let's talk about the JPK that's just come into the picture here, Lightworks.
Yeah, I mean, this class will be a race within the race again.
Yep.
And it's going to be fierce. And we've seen in the Vicarisia race that they finished after some 200 miles, they finished within a few minutes of each other.
Yeah.
So this is really putting a lot of pressure on them, because if the boats are sort of performing on an equal level, it's all about you. You don't want to be last.
Sure.
Michael Höfgen has had quite a career. He's from the south. He's a good sailor. He's actually also quite keen to...
Michael's in Lightworks, the beautiful boat that we can see on the left-hand side just going out of the picture.
Yeah. And he used to have a Hungarian boat, a very powerful boat with a swing keel and... or a canting keel, actually. And he was never really happy with the boat, even though it was blindingly fast when it worked. But he was... finally so much fed up that he decided to get something proper.
Isn't that the boat which snapped its keel off at the Vigvisier?
Exactly.
That was Michael bobbing around in the water for several hours.
Yes, yeah? That was him. So he's not shy of taking risks and going to the extreme. And for him now to have a boat which is really sort of bulletproof, a weapon as well, it's a new world for him, but he showed in the Vicarisia race that he can handle it. And I think it's just, this is one of the most demanding mini classes within the medium class.
Yeah.
But you also have a number of Jeannot Sunfast here.
The 3300 and the 3200, both very fast boats. Yeah.
And the 3300, which is the later one, the most modern one, is actually a good contestant to the JPKs.
Mm-hmm.
So this is also going to be interesting to see how they perform.
We've seen a lot of them at the Fastnet race a month ago, you know?
True.
We saw them right at the top of the list. I think the first 15 or 20 boats were just completely specked with the JPKs and the Sunfasts.
Exactly. So this is going to be fun. I mean, we don't know exactly the level of seamanship and boat handling of the skippers, but the boats are quite equal, and it will be fun to see who comes out in front.
Mm-hmm.
These boats can be pushed incredibly hard, and I think I doubt they will even consider a reef in some 20 knots of breeze. We'll see.
These guys are tough. And then the interesting thing about the JPKs, despite the fact that they're brilliant downwind boats, they've proven that they perform extremely well upwind as well. I mean, they're really, really strong boats. So the chances are that we're going to see some of these boats right there up the front of the boat, but at the front of the fleet. But let's not forget some of the other guys. I mean, let's not forget there are two Figaro twos here this year.
Well, yes, you know,
somebody's
yes.
here to bite Jan Hansen's
and actually a
heels.
Local hero.
Yeah,
Jan Hansen. I think we are going to see him in a minute because he's just sneaking up from the Fyn side behind the bushes.
He's coming out there. I can see him there. He's hiding behind the trees
yeah.
there.
So he's really closest to the starting line. He already has been there 15 minutes ago testing the tide, and I think he will be keen. And I think he will be the most experienced of the two boats. So if I have to put my money on one of the two Figaros, it's Jan, because he knows the waters. He's really... he's a very good sailor by himself, and the boat is really in tune. And I mean, he has an aluminum 43 footer, which he was taking part in the Silverrudder in earlier years, and now he got this Figaro, and he already bought a new boat. I think his Figaro is up for sale.
It is for sale, yeah. He's bought the new Alolus 30.
Yes, so so that's a boat that is also designed into, not exactly to the Silverrudder race, but it fits the class really well.
Yes, yeah.
So next year we will see him in a carbon 30 footer, which is extremely light, very powerful.
And I think probably we'll see him and Hans Genter, the designer and builder of the boat, racing against each other, which is going to be a lot of fun to see.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if
there
he is.
Beast. In
there
the
he
picture.
Is. Yeah. There's the boat's the beast. We'll just call Jan, and he's definitely a contender for the first place.
Yeah.
But there are other boats in this race. I know we're talking about these guys, and these are the surf machines and the tough beaters. But there are a couple of, you know, there's a whole fleet of X99s, and
yes,
I personally know one of them
the
very
race.
Very well, and I've raced with him, and he was a student of mine 20 years ago, and we raced together still. We raced J70s together, and we raced in his boat. And Thomas Nielsen is his name, and he actually was number three 2 years ago.
Wow!
And he completed last year as well. So we mustn't underestimate some of the other guys. I know they're not going to be planing at 20 knots in Northern Funen, but some of them are tough guys, and he's used to staying awake for many hours a day. I tell you.
There's one thing I want to point out here, because it's also related to one of the JPKs, and actually one of the most modern ones, the 1030. Anders Johansen, a Danish skipper. Beluga, yes, who has also been in the Vegrisier multiple times. He was in the Round Denmark race.
Mm.
When I first competed, I think it was my second race here in Svendborg, some 7 years ago, he was owning a Dela 34.
A Dela 36, 36
CWS,
I think it was.
With
yeah,
a central winch in the middle.
That's right, yes.
Electric winch to handle.
Yeah, yeah.
And we were fighting it out each other with each other up to Mittelfahrt. And
yeah.
then I was on a J109, so I had a slightly lighter boat, a bit faster. And I left, I sort of could leave him in my wake. And then when I woke up the next morning in the harbor, he was right next to my boat.
Oh, one must never underestimate Anders Johansen. He's a tough sailor, as he prove at the Round Denmark race.
Yes, and look at him. He had in between, when he sold his dealer, he had a Far 800 or something like that.
He had a Far 727 like a Gru has started in today, which is
maybe
okay.
2 years. And then he went up to a JPK. So he's a typical example of a sporty, well-rounded, sort of, I would say, performance-oriented cruising guy, but he was bitten by the bee of single-hand racing, and then he went into any race he could get a hold of, and he used sort of a more appropriate weapon, and now he's a skipper of a JPK.
And he's proven that he deserves position right at the front of the fleet in Northern Europe. We're not just talking about Danish races. Behind the white boat there is the Black Caravella.
Yeah,
let's talk
Polish
about
boat.
Him.
It's a sort of a mini class 40. It's a class 950. It's a boat that was sort of designed or a class designed in the wake of or after the big success of the class 40 in the beginning of the years after 2000. It was a very promising one because the idea was to have an affordable class 40, which could be raced sort of on a semi-pro level. And it's a very good boat. It's not perfectly optimized for upwind, but it's a weapon downwind.
And there are two of them here,
two
Polish boats. And but the one that we can see in the picture there with Thomas in this Black Caravella. I remember when he came in another boat identical to this 3 years ago, his first Silver Rudder. It wasn't finished. He was mounting the winches and the clamps, and he was mounting the all kinds of stuff for the last 3 days. And he's an amazing guy because he completed the race and did quite well. But last year he came second place. I think he was first or second at the Vegvisir. And this year he's back with 850 liters of ballast on either side of the boat. Ballast that can be moved in a longitudinal direction as well as in a vertical direction. So that boat's originally built with 400 liters. That was the 5 minute warning for the small class. And this is probably going to be one of the most exciting classes. Now, the X79s have gone, the first 27s have gone in the small, so we're up to the medium now, rather. This is the medium start, yep, which is starting now. I'm sorry, I said small. The medium start. And there's some real tough contenders here. The boat you can see in the picture here is Jakob Sinning in his Banner 30, which has got a slightly extended stern. Local guy. Further to the right there, Fleming. If you move the camera further to the right, see the boats there. There we go. We can see the black Caravella there. And there are a lot of what one could say cruiser racers here. A lot of Dela 34s and Dela 35s, the new SV models, Confortina 32s. Boats, one would say, they're good performance cruisers, but far from racers. Elan 350s rather, with the hard chines.
Yeah. Sort of a medium performance boat. And the boats we don't see at the moment because they're more conservative on the start line are Halberg Rassi's Bavaria 34.
Yes.
And it was so funny to see yesterday in the harbor to see a Bavaria 34 with a bowsprit for the Jennifer.
Yeah, amazing, isn't it?
And taped. And it looked like, here you have sort of a camper van, and you have the big slicks on
total
it.
Optimized racer at the front of the fleet. Then you've got, like you say, a camper van, a nice Halberg Rassi with a bowsprit on it. And like I said at the skipper's presentation yesterday, what makes this race quite remarkable is the fact that it's like a cannonball run. You can turn up in anything you
exactly,
like.
Exactly, that's
it. That fulfills the stability criteria, and then off you go. There's everything from Impala 31s to the J97s, and your relatively new modern boats, J100, very nice modern boat, which one could say is sort of cruiser racer, perhaps more over on the racer side. And then they're going to be racing against Sunfast 3300s, which are absolute total racing machines.
Yeah. And there's also a guy who I met on my first Silver Rudder, Udo Schallenberg. He converted from a Warship to a Sunfast 3200, with which he has also done quite a few Atlantic races, very long distance races to the Ace Horse. So it's funny, there was sort of a tendency to go racing, long distance racing, and then you do the Silver Rudder, you do it once, twice, you get a proper boat, and then it's
you're lost for the rest of the world. You spend the rest of your family's holiday budget on sails, on black sails.
And Jan Hansen is a good example, isn't he?
Sure,
he sold his sail loft.
Yes,
and now
right.
He's just sailing.
He's just sailing. That's what he does.
I think you can call him a professional now.
I reckon you could say that. I'm not sure if he makes a living doing it, but he's certainly having a hell of a good time trying. Yeah. No, and there are a lot of fun boats here. And there's a Dufour 34 performance, the E, and like I said, the Dela 34s. And they're all the interesting thing is, the amount of different nationalities that are here. And there's a Norwegian Sunfast 3200 you can just see turning to starboard there.
Mm-hmm.
And behind that, there's an X35. What do you think of the X35 in these conditions?
To be honest, they are beastie. You can lose them quite quickly. They're beautiful boats, but they're tricky to sail. And single-handing, if you get hit by a gust, the boat broaches violently.
I've had the pleasure of racing one quite a lot this year and last year, and I love the look of the boat, and I love the boat when there are eight of us sitting on the rail, beefing it out. But downwind, Chinese jiving all over the place. I got to say, the boat frightens the hell out of me. I was thinking about buying one, but then I thought about my family, and well, that was definitely not. It's a beautiful-looking boat.
2016, we had sort of a breezy start with some 20, 25 knots of breeze, and we were on a beam reach up Svendborgsund towards Ture. So this is where you cannot escape the wind. A gust hits, and you cannot luff up a lot because there is the shallows. You cannot go downwind because the boat is just has a tendency to broach, and a boat was literally doing a 90 degree bad broach. It was it was an X35 in front of me, and I had a heart attack. Really,
I don't blame you.
I was lucky not to hit it.
Well, that boat is completely out of control during those few seconds, isn't it? I mean, they just can't right her up again. I'm not sure if the rudder is too narrow, or or there's just too little righting moment at the stern.
Or both.
probably both. But it's a beautiful boat.
We won't see this today.
Look at this beautiful view here. This is Anders Johansson. We can see it. No, that's a German boat, so it isn't. I was going to say it's Anders Johansson in his JPK 1030. Look at the way the boats are all starting to move slightly to starboard. There's less than 30 seconds left for the start of the race. They're nowhere near the starting line, actually. They're well down, despite the fact they're all coming to starboard. And we're off. That's the start of the medium class. Look at this guy unrolling his Jennica here. Beautiful picture here.
That's Rasmus Töpsch. He's one of the inventors and founders of the Baltic 500. Mm-hmm. He's a very good sailor. He used to have an L30, which is sort of
lovely
a
light wind
boat. And now he has a proper offshore race boat.
And the yellow and black Jennica that you can see here is the Elan 350. Yeah. Also quite a modern boat with a built-in bowsprit, as you can see.
Yeah.
Hard chines. And just to windward of that is the Banner 30. He's got a good start, but he's decided not to set any head sails. Look at Jan Hansen in the background. Can you just go slightly to the right, Fleming? You want to see the blue Jennica. Yeah. Jan Hansen there reaching.
He's
aggressive. Look at him. He's flying through the rest of the fleet.
Yeah.
And he's going to make sure that he doesn't end up getting covered by too many boats to windward of him. That's a beautiful. And look at that. Just to windward of him on the right, you can just see. Go slightly right, please, Fleming. There you go. You can see light works in the JPK 1030 there.
With the orange graphics on the hull.
Yeah, but look at these guys. Don't estimate these X99s and the 332s. Also set and aggressive to go. Quite a few of them have set their spinnakers, even though they know they're not going to be able to carry the spinnakers as soon as they get round this first headland here. They're probably going to have to lower them again.
Yeah, it's pretty piled up in the first half of the fleet. In the second half, just approaching, will be the first Sunfast 3300 with the black sails. Is it the Norwegian boat? Yeah, that's the Norwegian one.
Mm-hmm. This one here, the 33004.
Yeah, just in the middle.
That's
the picture.
300. That's a beautiful looking boat. I mean, the 3200 is a good looking boat, but this is just slightly modernized, isn't it?
Yeah,
you see the coach roof comes back a bit.
It has a concave underwater body, slightly concave. It has a very plumb and full bow, so it can take a lot of pressure, and it's not nose diving easily. It's really a bare boat inside, and it's built
completely. It's empty.
It's built shitty inside, to be honest.
Yeah, there's nothing at all. No, it's completely empty.
Yeah, yeah.
Look at I don't know if we get the opportunity to see his head sail. Could you come to the right a little bit, Fleming, onto the black sail there? I'm hoping he'll take his head sail down slightly. There's a huge, great big, and the leech of that head sail is huge. They're designed especially so that there are curves that go between
The spreaders,
exactly. I'm surprised he's not putting up some more head sail. I mean, in a boat like that,
it doesn't look like he has it sort of attached to the guard wire or a code zero at hand. It seems like he's taking a very conservative approach.
And if you look at his head sail, Jochen, I'm going to pass you the binoculars. Actually, his head sail is very small. It's about a meter and a half missing from the luff. It doesn't go all the way up. You see that? It's much shorter.
Sure.
It looks like it.
No. I think it's just. It's just the top is not.
It's not.
It's not maxed up. Yeah. Yeah.
No. It's shorter. It's a meter and a half shorter on the headstay. Isn't that odd? And that's why he's been taken over by an X99. Is running straight through his lee.
Where's Jan Hansen in the front? He's still carrying his spinnaker.
While the Dutch.
Stay on the left picture there.
Can you see the batfish, the picture in the camera now?
He's following the top.
Yeah, that's the Dutch figure or two who's going to definitely be a contender. He said his ambition is to not beat Jan Hansen, but if he can keep up and bite his heels all the way around, he'll be happy. He's one of a delegation of three Dutch guys that came here together. Jetstream, a beautiful J122 was here last year, and he said, I love this. I'm bringing my friends next year. So they all sailed their boats to Nyborg, participated in the Vegvisje, and then they came down here, which is great.
It's funny, you know, this is like an anti-climax. It's the start and your heart is pumping, but the wind is sort of
moderate.
and of course the counter current is slowing down the fleet, so it looks like they're parking almost. It looks like a Sunday cruise.
It does, but it's quite nice for us. It
means 5 miles from here or six, there would be...
They're going to get their pumping.
Yeah.
This is a mild start to get some warmed up, but they're going to get wind. There's no doubt about that. There's plenty of wind out there. But you're right. For our sake, it's quite nice that we have time to comment and talk about the boats and stuff. You know, if they just plow out of here in 30 seconds, that would be that over and done with.
To be honest, as a skipper myself and as a commentator, I just don't want to see and witness sort of collisions on the starting line. So
no.
I'm really fortunate.
No, the two
there were slight groundings or park.
A little bit of excitement,
but no collisions. No. And that's the most important.
But thing. I'm quite surprised that there aren't more boats closer to us. You know, on this side of the line, and they must realize that there's. They're going to be covered by the trees there, you know, to the west, and they're not, you know, further down here getting free air, putting up a code zero perhaps instead of a heavy large Jenica, so they can reach out at least to start with. There's one boat that's got the idea there. You see that?
Yeah.
One boat has jived across. I think it's a JPK 1030.
That's Rasmus Töpf, the German JPK 1010.
Yes. It's a 1010, is it? Yeah.
Huge Jenicas.
Yeah, massive. It looks like he'll be able to carry it for quite a while down there and then jibe onto a starboard tack and then continue out the other side there.
He really had sort of the right impulse. He has free wind. He's heading for more wind, actually.
And where the rest of them just...
And get some respite of the current if he's out there to the left.
So we're just going to move away from last person back to the lump of boats. Look at this huge, great big pile of boats bashed together. I mean, they're not touching each other, but they've just got no free air.
Yeah.
And they're completely stuck, vacuumed in there. And I'm not going to stand on shore and be a smart guy, but I'm quite surprised to see some guys like Jan Hansen and stuff stuck there without free air.
But it looks like has his Jenica up and it's
And there's wind in it. Yeah. It's filled, yeah.
I think it goes for shortest
probably
distance.
That makes sense. And but look at this X332 here, look, on the left there. That, you see that? Who's Excalibur, who's got free air there, and it's coming onto the opposite side where there's a lot more wind. And he's not even flying an asymmetric head sail of any kind. And he's much faster than the rest of the fleet.
In the second half of the medium class, which is approaching the start line now, we have a Halberg Rossi with a spray hood. Nice.
Well, you never know what kind of weather to expect.
He will have a nice time.
He's going to have a nice cruise.
Some coffee.
Yeah, and just in front of him is an X35 there, which we were talking about before. Yeah.
Yeah.
So just look at that. I mean, there are sort of, somebody asked me yesterday, Philip, how do you guys dare to start 134 boats on the line at once? And I said, we dare because there's just a huge difference in the level of aggressiveness that these boats start with. Look at this. I mean, there's a BB 10 meter. I mean, if he was doing a national championship, he might as well park his boat and go home. But at a race like this, he may end up winning the entire race. You know, and there's an X35. And there's, you know, some people are here to win. Some people are here to just complete. And somebody here just to compete as much against themselves. Now, if I'm not wrong, there's even a boat there with a fender hanging over the side, like, see, with the big Elstrom on the sail. Indeed, there is. Can you see that?
Yeah.
I won't mention them.
I even have sympathy for these guys, because if you're a proud owner of your boat and if you're just frightened by the amount of boats around you, then why not keep the fender out for the
I don't think that's...
In case someone
you think, or you think it's tactics? I just think he forgot. I think that he was completely bunched up in the harbour, difficult to get out of the port. And it looks like, there he is, look there with the fender there. We won't mention his number. You'll probably see him as we pan in on the picture.
Flynn, perhaps you could go a little bit further. Oh, they're coming into the camera now. Or zoom out a little bit so we can get some more boats there.
There we go, beautiful.
Yeah, the yellow boat, which is sort of sneaking up from behind. It's a Rommel 33. That's a Berlin build. Let's say lake racer, which the yacht is not existing anymore. It's a light, relatively light and well performing boat. I don't think I would be wishing to be on it in the Kattegat with the 4.6.
It's that light, is it?
It's not that light, but it's tippy and it's rather narrow. So it's a good upwind boat, but downwind in the north No.
All right. What about the boat just to the right of it? Could we go just ever slightly to the right, Fleming, please? Behind the yellow boat, the Rommel. There we go. What do you think of the first 30? And you have to be polite now, because the gentleman who owns it is most upset that you criticized it in Yacht Magazine.
I know. I said, compared to modern designs, the boat was way too heavy, and compared also to the lines of Hu and Kay, who designed the boat.
Mm.
At the time, it was already sort of, it was an aggressive design, but the boat was too heavy and it was built too conservatively. And
right.
I think Beneteau learned a big lesson. And to be honest, this the first 30 from Hu and Kay, which was not a success in the marketplace. I know that they're selling well. I mean,
we sure, did okay. Size
the
yeah,
boat, but
yeah.
They are not flying boats. You know, if you have a Force 5 and a Jennaker or a Code Zero up, you can do 10, 11 knots, but then you hit a wall. And
sure. But do you think it was designed to be a flying boat?
Well, if it comes from Juan K,
then
yes,
it should. And with the hard chines and the double rudders, it has the ingredients of a flying boat.
Yes, but then again, it was just, it didn't have enough sail area. It was too heavy. And it's a pity, but for Beneteau, this is sort of like a shock. You know, you feel Michel Deschouilleau was helpful in the final phase of the design to make it quick and to actually promote the boat. Juan K is one of the best most innovative designers, but it was just too heavy, basically. And and to be honest, that Beneteau bought Seascape, and that Seascape has now designed or is building the first 36 is testament to Beneteau realizing that a sport boat of this caliber cannot be produced next to ordinary cruisers, average white boats.
It's either or. Yeah?
So this is a watershed event for Beneteau, and we just have commented on this. And I know that every owner sort of feels
personally attacked.
Punctured, yes.
let's look at the fleet here. No, you shouldn't be sorry. I was just actually, I found it quite amusing because he keeps giving you a hard time every time I talk to you about it. I talk to him about his boat.
Well, if
we look at the fleet here, these are still boats in the medium style, which haven't crossed the starting line yet. And we've got some really fast boats. So we've got one designs. We've got the old, 35OD. We've got the an X35 right here in front of us here. I mean, so remember, this race is about much more than just crossing the starting line first. The green boat, you can't see it in the picture anymore, is one of the Dutch boats. That's a boat that's built especially for the Fastnet 3 years ago. They were built three of them. Looking at, amongst that, one of the heavy halberd rashes there, the one with the 57-inch sail, there's the Bavaria 35 Matcher there, and there's a combination of boats, some of them, which are real performance boats, but, just like we're saying, this is a boat where the individual helmsman or skipper's ambitions very much reflect where and how he wants to circumnavigate Funen. Look at this bunch of boats here. Fleming, if you could just zoom out on all the boats here. To the right on the actual starting line, not one of them is carrying a Jennaker or an exotic head sail. There's one with a Code Zero there, which he's trying to sail deep. But look at this.
Yeah, and still, even though they are not sort of giving it their all, I think to be on the start line in such a big fleet, not to be afraid of some severe weather in the north, is making them better skippers. And this is one of the effects of the Silverrudder. It has brought sort of a new generation of boats to the Baltic, like the JPKs, for instance, like the Seascapes. It has really helped grow the sporty, sort of short-handed part of the market, which wasn't presented very well before. And the other thing is it helps all of us becoming better skippers, becoming sort of more profound, more well-rounded skippers.
Do you think we've become bigger, more daring than we were before? Do you think that some of these people were conventional cruisers and they said, well, look, all kinds of boats are participating and completing, the Silverrudder and the Baltic 500. Do you think one could say that cruisers have got to, and that their level of braveness has increased?
Slightly and step by step, yes. Since I was here from the second race on for until 2018 was my last race. No, 17. I could really see that the ordinary guy with sort of, a Hansa 350, in the first race, he didn't even have a Code Zero or a Jennaker.
Yeah.
Then he had a code zero but didn't have a bowsprit. Next year he had a bowsprit, and it was adding and adding and adding. And,
sure.
And you were just getting sort of more complete with your boat, but also more complete as a sailor.
So the sailmakers love this race.
I think they should, because on average there's a Jeneco on one out of 10 boats.
Yeah, I would agree.
And
I agree.
I think here, even though we don't see them all, I think there is one Jeneco. Out of 10 boats, they're 8.5.
I was going to say 9. I would have said 9. Yes. And if there isn't 10, it's because it's broken at all on the tour before the race. Yeah. Jochen, thanks a lot. We're going to go offline for a few seconds now. We'll leave the camera panning over the beautiful scenery there with the boats behind us. Thanks a lot for joining us. I've asked you to come here for a couple of starts, and you've been here for more than that. Thank you. The next start to start will be the large boats, and I've asked Torben Kornum from Exyacht to join me here. And he'll be here in just a few minutes when we come back. Thanks. Stay tuned.
Hi, we're back again here, just warming up for the large start of the Silverrudder 2021. About 70 boats will be on the start for the large class, and standing next to me is Torben Kornum from X Yachts. Welcome back. I know you landed from Italy last night.
That's true.
Thanks for making the trip here. Good to see you.
Thank you very much.
Torben, and behind me is Torge Lugge, who will be talking and interviewing Torben Kornum. One of the exciting things about this class is that your boss is participating, but you can tell Charles more about that, yeah?
I will. I look forward to seeing our CEO, Crane Brink Nelson, doing the best he can here in the X4.0.
Brilliant. I mean, the start's in about 7.5 minutes. I'm going to stand aside and let Charles and Torben talk about X Yacht's participation in the Silverrudder. All yours, Torben.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Philip. And welcome, Torben.
Thanks, Charles.
First of all, what are you doing in X-Yachts? What's your job?
My job is I'm working with the markets around the world, so globally, actually handling the dealer network, and of course also involved in the sales department and various other things.
I just met you on the Cannes Boat Show.
That's true.
How was that?
It was a wonderful boat show, a very very large boat show with actually two harbors full of very nice boats, very very impressive setup, and it was warm and nice.
And now it's cool and raining in Denmark.
I'm back in Denmark, yes. Yeah. I went from Cannes boat show and onto the Genoa boat show in Italy. That was also very very impressive boat show.
And you are a former ex boat sailor, isn't that true?
I'm still an ex boat sailor. I've owned three ex yachts. And I've just ordered a new one coming in 2022.
Which one?
The 4.3. There's a new, very, very nice model coming in 22.
So it's different from the other one, or?
Yeah, it's a different one. It's a new. The many new exciting things about the new one. Yes.
Yeah.
And based on the former or the present 4.3, but still with a number of very nice details.
And can you tell me why is X-Yacht so interested in this Silverrudder?
First of all, because it's a fantastic event. It's got what sailing is all about. We want to support the event itself, and with that also the sailing sport in general. I believe it's also very good inspiration for our dealers, because they get inspired when they see us getting involved in this kind of events, and so altogether it's
sorry, 5 minutes to start. Yeah,
okay.
And then you can say that your boats are made for two hand or one hand sailing, is that true?
Yeah, but for sure they are.
They're not made for man and wife who's sailing it.
Absolutely, we see more and more people are sailing just double handed. But yes, you're right. Any X-Yacht can be easily sailed single handed. So we're also showing that part of it. But basically, all boats can be sailing single-handed.
Yeah, but then you have to run around the boat. And which boat are Crane Nielsen?
Crane is sailing the X4.0, and it's a fun story, because it's actually a boat that we had set into a charter project this year. So basically it's been rented out all summer. It's been a great success, and now that the summer ended or the charter season ended, he took it, cleaned the bottom, and he just went straight out and
4 minutes to race, yeah. And
I think they're quite far down. If it's 4 minutes to the race, I would say
they are far away from it.
Thanks, Trolls.
Hurry up.
Yeah, well, thanks a lot, Trolls. And you know, come back to us in just a few minutes when the start is gone. 4 minutes to start, and a very, very conservative start by the big boats here. I'm concerned that perhaps the boats haven't been able to get out of the harbour, but the only boats that could have blocked them would have been the medium boats, so we should be fine here. The current is still against the boats as they start, as you can see. There's about, I'd guess, about 0.8 to 1.2 knots of current against them. A bit cloudy, same amount of wind. The wind hasn't started turning around just yet. It's still very much from a northeasterly direction, but you can see the flag on the other side there. There's not that much wind in here. There's more wind on this side than on the other side. And you can see the boat sort of turning, you know, on the picture here, that they end up going sideways. There are two Ulves there, old classic Nordic boats. Coming to the picture here is a 362. That's Joran. No, that's not. No, there's a 360. The 382 here, the one last year, Torben, a Swedish guy.
Ah. I think actually it's more than 1 knot of current. Philip, I think it's
the boy there. You're probably right.
Yeah, it's a couple of knots.
Yeah, and bearing in mind the boats we can see on our left, you can't actually see here, are having a bit of a hard time even getting out of the sound. Yeah. There's probably a lot more than
it's
one.
It's not an easy start here.
I'm just going to say hi. I'm going to take you to the plane tonight.
Have a good flight.
Yeah, it'll be great.
It's very exciting. We wished we were there. Didn't we? Wouldn't you have liked to sail there?
And everybody asks, why don't you race anymore, Philip? Well, because I spend all my time chatting to you guys instead. But I'm enjoying this as well. I got to say, I enjoy doing this. But it's much easier to just sit in a boat and race, especially now that I've got a bigger boat. Yeah. We were talking about earlier. I mean, the real marathon men of this race are the guys in the Seascape 18s and the CB20 66s. Yeah, all the tough boats to race. Yeah. This is relatively, it's not cruising, but it's relatively easy going once the boat's, you know, is off and the sails are up. It's not really, really hard work.
No.
Some of the guys are going to be a lot more ambitious than others. You know, some of these guys are here to win and others are just here to complete the race.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can just see, you can't actually see, but just slightly to the right is the Open 40, Black Maggie, which is definitely a contender. And I asked him yesterday, you know, what do you think of the weather forecast? He said, I haven't looked at it yet. and he's the coolest guy in the world. And I don't think he has looked at it yet. He's smooth.
I bet our ex-Yacht CEO, Crane, is putting on the heater in the boat. And
you think so?
Yeah, I'm sure he's
got his batteries charged up.
Yeah, I'm sure he has. I know he's definitely, he's here for the fun and for the experience. He hasn't had a lot of time to prepare for the race.
That's
so,
1 minute to the start, and we can hardly even see the boats. They're nowhere near the starting line. You can see a few of them just coming into the camera here. That's one of your older boats, an X119 on the picture there, number 352. Yeah. Now, it's interesting to see that they're far away from the starting line. They've obviously been surprised by the current, don't you say? Mm.
Yeah.
Look, this is the Black Maggie setting his Jenica, huge, great big sail out onto the Sprit.
It seems like
that. And he's ambitious. I mean, he's an exceptionally good sailor. Do you remember, this is the boat that was extended. He's the record holder in the medium class, and this boat's been extended to the large class, and he's built the boat and the mast and everything himself.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, it's gorgeous. Yeah, it's absolutely
beautiful.
Gorgeous.
Yeah. It'll be exciting to see how it's going with the current when he gets a bit further.
This boat has foils or dagger boards. You can see there's quite a lot of turbulence on the left-hand side. Can you span in slightly to the left there on the black Maggie there?
So it's got foils on the...
It's got dagger boards. You can see just sticking up there.
Ah, yeah. Okay, I got it.
Okay, he's going to be spot on the line, looking at the starting clock and looking at his performance. He's going to be with the first boat and the only boat to be right up on the line for the start. I'm hoping that it's going to go any second or that it doesn't start too early.
I see Crane coming now.
Can you?
Which boat is it?
Black
sails.
Oh, yeah.
DN29.
And just see if I can find it. Oh, there he is. Yeah, with the grey sails. Yes. Yeah, lovely. Yep. Just behind the big J boat there.
And,
you see this,
and the blue X.
Yeah.
36.
Yeah, the 36 Sport there.
36 Sport,
yeah. That's a Danish boat as well. He's participated. Oh, this is his first of the rudder. I spoke to him earlier today or yesterday. And this boat here is the X382, won in the extremely light winds last year.
Mm.
And I mean, we haven't got the camera onto him, but Black Maggie is the only boat which really is powering up. He set his big Jenica and he's off. Can you pan slide to the left? We can just see Black Maggie. Off to the left. Maybe. There he is there, powered up full speed, leaving the sound. But you know, there isn't that much wind, and the more with this sail, he can't go as deep as he'd like to, which means he has to keep on going further and further to starboard, going closer to the wind, which also means he gets closer and closer to the trees where there's going to be lee and shelter.
But less current, I think.
And less current, probably. And but the comfortina behind him is coming up nicely as well. It looks like he's probably got an A3, which he probably can reach a little bit higher to the wind as opposed to Black Maggie's A2.
What a fantastic start.
What a fantastic start. And look at these boats. I mean, don't kid yourselves.
Here's an IMX 40, I think.
Indeed it is.
It's also a very fast boat.
And there's a first 40.7 or further on the right. If you go slightly right again, you pan out, please. There's quite a lot of J boats here as well, J35s, and there's a 39, three 122s. And there's certainly one J122, which is worth watching. They won the Vegvisir. Actually, no, they didn't. They got a second place. They went aground about half a mile before the finishing line. They're definitely worth watching. Part of what we call the Dutch delegation. That's definitely going to be worth watching. And you've got Remy Provost from a local guy from Northern Funen in his J112, very fast boat as well. Where's Crane?
He's in the middle, actually. Going quite well on.
Great.
On
there he is, actually. Yeah, number 29, is that what
yes.
you
Yes.
Yeah, 29,
yeah.
Good. Let's hope he doesn't go too far to windward and get below the trees there. Nice.
So if you look at the X-Power boat, the red boat.
Yes.
The current. I don't know if we can zoom in on it, but see the current where he is.
Can you go slightly left, please, Fleming? So the X-Power just in front of the races?
It's one of the X-Power boats that we have set in here in order to provide some VIP service, you know, for journalists and who else is interested to get out there.
Some of the youngsters that we coordinated yesterday, they had a trip out this morning and watched the first start. They love that.
It's a fun
experience for a lifetime.
Fun ride as well. Yeah.
But this is a funny start because you know there are all kinds of different boats here. We interviewed a guy in a dealer Varianta 37, which isn't really a racing boat at all, but he's put a longer keel, carbon rudder, higher mast, you know, the full works, everything, and has made it into a real performance boat. And he said, look, this is the one you can just see in front of us, in fact, in the grey boat we call Diva there, with a white head sail.
Yeah.
And he said it's really fast. That boat can plane. Now, a dealer Varianta is certainly not considered to be a planing boat normally. Mm. I'm wondering where the Ulvas are, the long, narrow ones. There's one there, look, with the blue spinnaker, if you go a bit to the left by the house there, a bit further, that's sort of leading the fleet there, all the way around, further to the left. We've got quite a long way around to the start of the fleet with Black Maggie and the spinnaker. There you go, there's the X336, you can see there, a little bit further to the left, let me. There you go. Remember, they're the only boat which has set a spinnaker, and that's going to be very, very helpful once he rounds the corner there, where he can reach slightly higher to the wind. And definitely accelerate compared to some of the boats that haven't set spinnakers that are going to have difficult to maintain the depth into the wind there.
For sure. It seems like the wind is filling in a little bit from, it must be south from here, right?
That's right. Yeah, that's south. Yeah. Well, south would be down there. Yeah.
Or southwest.
Well, they have forecast a slight increase of wind. And I mean, these boats, as soon as they round the corner by two, there's going to be a lot more wind.
Yeah. Wonderful.
It is a fantastic sight, and when you came here you're straight from Italy and you saw the middle start, you said, wow, what an event. And it really is. We are overjoyed by the support that we've received from the participants, of course.
I can imagine.
And by you guys, you know, all the partners and sponsors that want to take part in this event. We're delighted by that.
It's very nice for us also to feel all the participants are so happy. It's really a lot of positive comments, and you know, we get a lot of positive feedback also on our side, because they really love this event.
What do you think it is that ex-owners like about this event? I'm not, because the ex-owners are particularly different to other races, but what sort of feedback do you get back? You know, what makes them more like this event particularly?
First of all, I think the average ex-yacht owner is normally quite a good sailor, and very often also competitive sailors, and so So it's in their DNA, I think, that they like to compete.
Yeah.
But the feeling of going that far single-handed in a boat of your own that you know so well, you know, of course it's a nice, it's a fun, great
sure.
challenge.
Yeah. And the pictures we can see on the screen now are from the small start. This is a first 27 SE. And interesting, there was a boat from the medium class just in front of it. You can see the one there, that's the Geno 3200 and the Sunfast 3200. So, you know, the fleet has already started to mix, so the starts have mixed. It'd be interesting to see where the minis are compared to the smalls and the mediums. So Torben, Kren was up on the stage yesterday, and he presented the prize draw, the gift of using an X40 for a week for one of the volunteers. That was great. Now that was a great success. I mean, obviously, I'd like for some of the youngsters at the Ore Training Academy here to have won that. I think that would have been great as they've participated actively, and they're going to be doing tough long night watches here. But do you think that's something that you guys are going to be doing in the future?
I think so, because it's created so much goodwill and so much good talking on the internet, and we like the feeling of or the idea of supporting all the volunteers here, because it is really an amazing job that you're doing with this event. So I think we couldn't give the prize to a better audience than the volunteers. And yes, for sure, we'll do it again next year.
And if that, you let us. Yo, absolutely. We just love having you on board. The guy in the picture, this is Jan Hansen in the Beast. The cameraman just has shot past him, unfortunately. But that Jan Hansen in the Beast, and he's definitely a contender to win the... Great. We're going back onto him. He's definitely a contender to win the medium class. And I can see that he's just about to have left Svendborg Sound. And very soon, there's a green buoy on his port side. He'll round that. And he'll bear away slightly out towards Tuoro, and then once he rounds that, he's going to be flying. So there'll definitely be more clear air there. Sorry to go to leave the subject, but
no.
It's great to have you on board. It's great to have you here. And quite honestly, we noticed that we have a new caliber of volunteers here. I've got certainly sailing friends and sailing competitors that suddenly think it's a good idea to help out with the Silverrudder, because not only is there the motivation of you know being part of this, but also the fact that they can be rewarded, which is a great gift.
Yeah,
and the First have done the same. They awarded the use of a First 24 SE in Croatia for a week, and the couple that it's really nice. The couple that won it, I think they're about 80 years old. So I'm intrigued to see And I said, "Are you going to make use of that?" She said, "Oh yes, definitely, absolutely." They'd sailed in Croatia or in the Mediterranean before, so they definitely wanted to participate.
That's good.
We're back to this is the stern of the boats that have just started. This is the large class with the Ulvas and the large X boats. And can we see Kane? I think he's just to windward there, isn't he?
I think he was around 15th after.
Are you counting?
I did. I think he actually made quite a good start.
Brilliant. That's good. That's good. So you can't give him a hard time on Monday morning back at the office.
Not on that one, at least. There are many other things.
Torben, I'm going to pass you on to Tols here. I know he's keen to talk to you.
Okay.
But I would definitely say that you're right, that the wind is picking up. There's definitely a little bit more wind coming in here.
It's filling in
just
now.
Down through the sound, which is about right. They're saying the wind should veer slightly to the right, and which will mean the boats that are setting their Jennikers and Spinnikers are definitely going to benefit. Tols, whenever you're ready, I'll hand you over to Torben. There's 20 minutes to the next start, which is the extra large boats and our third last start. Go ahead.
Thank you, Philip. So do you like to be here, Tom?
Yes, for sure. I do like to be here. I the only thing that would be better was to be out there.
Yeah. So do you think it's the most important is the current or is it the wind?
Yeah, obviously it's a mixture. I would say the current is strong here. And I think the wind is just playing its game as usual in a narrow sound, but the current seems to be pretty constant. I would say more than one knot of current now. So yes, probably the current is the most important at the moment.
Yeah, there we see an X32. a very popular model, especially in England, I know, but also in Denmark.
Yeah, very difficult to come by.
Yeah, it's hard to find.
Almost impossible.
You tried,
but Philip, isn't that true? You're looking for one, Philip.
Look how beautiful! Look how beautiful it is. And imagine sailing around this Fyn island and seeing those beautiful places. It's amazing.
This is that's the headland right at the end of Tour. Absolutely beautiful. What we call Garsten. Yeah. And this is the stern of the boats. These are the sterns of the boats that we just started. There's a large class of boats. It looks like there isn't much wind, but in fact there is quite a lot of wind. But they're battening against about 2 knots of countercurrent, which means they're probably only going about, I don't know, they're
two three knots.
3 knots.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
So they're talking about having up to 10 meters per second?
Yeah.
22 knots.
Yeah. So that's around 130 miles around the island.
Yeah, 134 if you go under the western bridge.
So when do you think, Tom, there will be?
In no idea. We never know.
When will your bus be in the harbor?
Well, I hope. I hope he'll make it before it gets dark, because I know he's not. he likes to get to bed early. So but I'm wondering what he's doing.
Yeah, the wind.
Yeah, he really likes to go to bed early. So I think he's
not a party animal.
His biggest challenge is to stay awake. So
I hope he's come to the right party then.
Yeah, but tomorrow morning I'm sure he'll be flying, because he's up there.
What do you mean he gets up really early in the morning?
Oh yeah, super early.
We can see that behind the large boats that have started, you started to see some of the extra large boats. And in front of us here is the huge Hansa, which is owned by Peter Vrede, owner of the what has probably become one of Northern Europe's largest boat painting companies. And in front of that is Martin Meridin and his landmark 43. Hmm. And in fact, the first multi-hulls have started to come onto the water now.
Dragonfly.
Yeah.
Wow.
Hendrik Boy in his large Vasa 38 sailmaker.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
And there's a large, an old Luffe 40 or a 44 perhaps even there. We'll have those boats in the camera very shortly. Some of these boats are just coming up behind the large fleet to check out the current and check the wind direction and so on. And a fleet of extra large boats is smaller. I mean, we'll see about 35 boats on the starting line here, but these are boats from 40 feet upwards, and we've got boats like relatively heavy Sweden yacht 42. We've got quite a few of the older X boat series, the X412, which is is a timeless classic. We've got next generation, the X 482s, and then you've got the boats like the XP44s. Two of those here, Richard Roth, who's a record holder, the Norwegian, Paul Stiansen.
I think Paul Jensen,
he's the record holder.
Yeah. From Norway.
Rikard is the gentleman in Zaar who went aground
exactly
a few years ago. Yeah. I met him on the harbor the other day. And
he actually bought a brand new XP44.
I know he did. I know who bought his old one.
Yeah, I know.
Which is good.
So it's not a secret
any
longer.
It's not a secret anymore.
Okay.
He left the guessing.
Okay.
And you've got boats like the Loafers, the Loafer 40 that I talked about.
Yeah.
Heavy old, not heavy old, but a lovely Grand Soleil 43 out there. Loafer 48, we've got a lot of, this is where the big boats are. I mentioned Peter Vrede's, a Hansa 470, which is completely spunked up. You've got Jan Muller, he's definitely worth mentioning here, Jan Muller's racing his one-off Sherman Frez design 49, complete epoxy carbon boat. Mm. That's definitely a contender for the win here.
And he's very experienced, you can say.
Yeah, but way up there amongst the most experienced racers at all in Denmark. I would probably dare to say he has more nautical miles below his belt than any other guy in Denmark, at least. And you've got a local guy in his Comet 41S, Nils Larsen. That's a fast boat too. That can surprise a few of us. Vincent Baguli, I don't know him personally, but he's bought a Cayenne 42 this year and has actually only just started sailing.
Mm-hmm.
He's apparently has a pretty tough man's background, and he sailed over here on his own, which was his first single-handed sail at all. So he's worth watching. met the X-Plan, a very young man, if one of my students, in a boat that his dad built, a 45-foot steel cruiser, which weighs 13 tons.
Really?
Yeah, he participated in that before, and he's also raced and competed in X-79s. He sold his X-79 a year ago. Hmm.
And here comes, if we go a little to the right, we can see Michael Andersen, X-55. Yeah.
And it's for sale. We can tell.
It's the biggest boat in the fleet by far. It's 55 feet long. And
it's a beautiful boat.
It really is. I don't mean to put you on the spot, but you know the depth of draft of that boat?
I would say close to 3 meters. Probably 290. I'm not quite sure, actually.
Which
but
is
probably
be
290.
Which factor, isn't it? That's
yes.
That's to restrict him from too much movement.
Yes. Wow. So beautiful boats here.
Well, seems that we have a little bit more wind.
Yeah, again, it's filling in from southwest. There's also a swell coming. So maybe it helps them a bit.
It all looks very relaxed and calm, doesn't it? Yeah. I assure you, when you're maneuvering a 55-foot boat that close to other boats in this much current, so close to each other, then they may look relaxed, but I assure you that they are definitely, their nerves are tensed up, and they're ready for race.
Yes.
Yeah, it's nice. You can hear my Jenny Scheufens, who's, I don't know if you can hear in the background, who's doing the commentary. Are we pointing at the, are you pointing at the that you started?
No, the blue.
The Hanse.
Hanse. Is that a Hanse?
It is, it's a Hanse 480. So that's Peter Vrede, the one I mentioned.
Okay.
470, rather.
Okay.
But interesting, the boat just to the left of him is a boat that started in the large class, and it's only just started the starting line, and it is now 12 minutes to the start. So I'll repeat what I said when people ask me, Philip, how do you guys dare to start 130 boats on the line at once? I said, well, it's a very long starting line.
Yeah.
And some of the guys are still docked when the race starts. There's a boat that's gone aground down there. Do you see that down at the bottom there?
Yep.
Yeah. I don't know if you can pan around to that.
That's a bad start.
Right down at the down there at the bottom near the entrance into Skorpsund, as we call it. Yeah. It looks like quite a big boat. I'll just get my binoculars out.
And if he's using the engine, he will go out or has to go out?
Yeah, he'll have to
be
disqualified. Unfortunately, it's the beautiful large Arkona, I think it's an Arkona 40 or 39, which is a real shame to sail all the way here from Sweden and only 800 meters from the starting line, you run aground there. Yeah.
But Torben Kornholm, you're an experienced sailor. What do you think the start is important in such a race?
The start is always important, of course. Obviously less in a race that's 130 miles. But yes, it's always important. It's a competition in the big competition. Who gets the best start? So who gets the honor of taking the start?
But I just mean we saw the there was a good German sailor who made a good start and he gets some free wind.
Yeah.
And if that don't have the wind and you got the current against you, then you got a problem. So what do you think?
What do I think? Well, it's always good to have a good start.
Yeah.
At least after the race, you can talk to your friends and say, hey, I got the start. Did you see me? So maybe it doesn't mean big thing in the overall. Tell me, is that a coronet, Elvstrom coronet, in the race as well?
And if you take my binoculars, Torben,
I take my hat off.
The sails look like they're about 55 years old, like the boat.
Wow.
Is. And he's starting in the extra large boat. You can just see him pan.
Yes.
And this boat behind it, in front of it, I'm at 340. That's in the large or medium start. So that boat's about an hour behind the starting line. So
that's good.
If you say that's in the large start, he's okay. But if he's in the medium start, he's going to be disqualified for crossing the line more than 60 minutes after start.
I hope
so
not.
He's way behind there. And looking in front of the camera here is a Molik 10 meter.
Yes.
Beautiful classic Danish boat. And it's great to see a boat like that right next to Peter Vrede, gorgeous Hansa.
Is that Fleming or Fjord?
No, I don't think. No, he sails an Ulva.
Ulva, yeah, that's right.
And again, some of the boats there, look, haven't even crossed the starting line yet. No. The Finnish boat there hasn't set his head sail. I'm surprised at that.
I think there's a reefed mainsail here.
Well, that's the Norbol 40.
Okay. Okay. He's ready for the wind then.
He's ready indeed. He's all set, prepared. That must come as sort of a nasty surprise when you leave the port and you're all reefed up and stuff and you come out here and you discover there's really no wind at all. Mm.
But Philip, how many hours do they have to complete the race?
You have until 12 o'clock on Sunday. You have until 12 o'clock on Sunday. So the boats that started at 10 have got a couple of extra hours compared to the boats that starting at 1, the trimarans, which is fair. Yeah, it means they got a little bit extra time. So 48 hours on average. Yeah. This is Batfish, you can see in the picture. That's the Dutch figure or two, and he should be right up there behind Jan Hansen. But the last time we saw Jan Hansen, he'd set a downwind Jenica and was roaring off. And looks like this guy's doing about 5 knots, baby. So even though he threatened to stay on Jan Hansen's heels, he's going to have to change tactics.
He's on a cold sail.
Fulfill that dream, that's right. Yeah, and it just doesn't. A code zero is fantastic from a beam and forward of the beam, but behind, you know, after the beam, it's just a no go.
Yeah.
It needs some free wind from the mainsail.
Exactly.
I'm looking forward to seeing some of the really big boats. I mean, there's only about 8 minutes to start, and I'm quite surprised we haven't seen any of the large and the XP 44s. And I'm also looking forward to see Silver, which is a brand new Luffe 45 DS. It's, you know, it's actually built, and Biwa and his wife Mayenne, and Mayenne's doing the commentary here. I mean, they're real Silverrudder fans. Mayenne wrote, "We're thinking about calling it Silverrudder," and I said, "I said, Mayenne, but what happens if this race stops being, you know, the huge success that it is? Why don't you just make do with just Silver, you know, instead of Silverrudder?" So it's called Silver, and it's painted silver, and it's brand new and just been built, and it's actually gorgeous looking boat. Luffe 45. Deck saloon, but it's not just a Luffe 45, it's been extended at the bow and the stern, great big long bowsprit, and they had a Luffe 43 before. Let's see who else we've got here. Notice the way these big boats are standing off a bit.
They're just behind the forest.
They're just behind the trees there,
behind the trees.
We'll see them in just a second. I can see that we've got our camera on Peter Wade. He's getting a lot of publicity. If he puts that boat for sale today, he'll be shot off in no time at all. His boat's called Peppermint. It is a Dela, or is a Hansa 470. Okay. But behind him is the Elstrom Coronet, and that's in the large start. So that boat should have started 28 minutes ago.
Okay.
But he's in no hurry. Can you see he's reefed his Genoa? Just in case.
Yeah.
That's a surprise.
That's good.
Yeah, this race is for all kinds.
Yeah.
And what I'm more surprising is the Finnish boat out there, which looks like a Jeannot, and he doesn't even have his head sail up.
No. I hope he has a head sail.
It's a Finnish boat, but he's flying a German flag. Oh, he's not a contender. There are two guys in the boat.
Okay.
So he's forgiven. Before we give him a really hard time.
But Philip, you had this skipper meeting. You talked to all the sailors yesterday. What was that about? I mean, is there anything new about this in the Corona times, or you don't talk about Corona anymore?
Well, I've got to be honest, the Corona was not on the agenda. We'd written to all the sailors 3 weeks ago and said that a requirement for the sailors to participate was that they were all either vaccinated or they had a PCR test. And we haven't, in contrast to some other countries and other races, we haven't, you know, tested that they have these requirements fulfilled, because it's no longer a Danish requirement. So we would like them all to take care of each other and be safe. But the skipper's meeting was really just about getting you guys around Foon as safely as possible. Safety requirements, rules of the road, using the correct lights at night. You know, we want to make sure that everybody gets around the race safely. Everybody has to wear a life jacket 24/7 whilst racing. We talked about giving each other a wide berth. That'll be the 5 minutes for the extra large start. A very conservative start. We can hardly see any of the boats yet. So the skipper's meeting was, I would say, I'm not going to say it was a success, but people like what we do. A lot of good questions. We had Sebastian Wacke, a German meteorologist, doing the weather for us. Unfortunately, our own meteorologist, Mette Hundale, was at a knitting festival on Fanø. Yeah, seriously. So she, unfortunately, had to pass on the job to somebody else. But Sebastian's coming here next year to do it live for us, which is exciting.
Perfect. Look, they've got nice wind now.
Yeah, looking at the pictures here, beautiful.
Beautiful.
And that's a large and a medium boat you can see there.
Yeah. J97.
That's a good looking boat.
Do you have some a lot of new people in the race, or is it the same and the same people?
No,
are
about 25 of the racers are actually new, which is great. I mean, we can see, recognize, we see the names, we see the faces of our old friends. I mean, and we just love them coming back. But it's also great to see new sailors in all the classes. That's 4 minutes to the start, guys. Nice to see new racers here, you know, from all generations and all sizes of boats. You know, but word of mouth just spreads. Our website isn't great. It's not because we do a lot of work with the media and stuff. I mean, I work hard at it, but it seems to be word of mouth. Men of our age put it in their bucket lists. I've been contacted by a couple of journalists this weekend saying, hey, Philip, what are we going to do to get more women to participate in this race? And I said, well, we're thinking about setting up a program of some kind. So they can, we're not going to donate tickets. People, you know, can join the race if they can make it on the 6th of March next year.
Yeah.
When we start selling tickets, but we'd really love to have more women participants. You know, if we can.
But you have some nice drone, and you have nice media. In this way, you take the media serious, and we got Fleming to produce it.
Fleming's a genius.
Yeah, I mean, it's just not. But yeah, with good sound and all that stuff.
Talking about women in sailing, there are actually a lot of women getting into sailing.
Really? Yes.
There is. And not least thanks to the J70 project, the Sailing
Absolutely.
League.
Which you're very much involved in.
Well, we're sponsoring. Yeah. X-Sharks is sponsoring the league. And they were part of our Gold Cup also, the Gold Cup party in Aarhus just a couple of weeks ago. And there are really many women into the sport, and it's super positive. I agree, it could be nice to have some women, more women participating.
Six or seven women on the starting line just isn't enough. I mean, and like you say, if you go to the J70 leagues, you know, I participate in, we're getting whipped by women every single race. They're really, really good.
Yeah.
Excellent sailors. So they just have to get some self-confidence or buy a boat or get to borrow somebody's boat
for sure.
And get on the starting line.
Yeah.
This is, in my opinion, very achievable.
I think
the most difficult thing about this race is getting a ticket and mental preparation. Believe in yourself.
Yeah.
I think Gru Klok is a fantastic example. She bought a boat 82 days ago and is on the starting line today. She got a wild card. She was given a wild card to be the first woman sailor to register.
Just around the trees here.
Yeah, I'm sorry that we're not
the big boats.
We're not filming the extra large starts, but they're all too far to the right. You know, they're way away from the starting line.
But
so as soon as they appear, we'll pan back to them. Yeah.
Yeah.
But they have to stop them also 5 minutes before the race.
They're not allowed to have the engine running 4 minutes before the race, and never in the starting zone within the 4 minutes. So they can leave the engine running after the 4 minutes. As soon as they are within
into
the mark, demarked by the orange boy over there and an orange boy on this side, then they must have the engine stopped.
Okay.
So the only person really right up there again up the line is
the Hansa. Peter
Vader. Yeah, it's Hansa. And you've got a lovely X412 that will be coming. You can just see coming to the picture there.
Yeah.
Unfurling his Genoa. Huge, great big head sail those boats are born with. And that's number... That was the... 1 minute to extra large boats, and there's only one boat up there by the line there. The others are being very
We can see Mikael Andersen coming in his X55,
and to windward to of the him right is an XP44.
Yeah, that's
You can say people are they are not very aggressive here in the start, so they are very.
No, it's not an XP44. This one here is okay. So yeah, sorry. Because closest is Xbox with Henrik Jørgensen in Xbox.
Henrik needs to be mentioned, and I keep on and on mentioning him.
Yes.
The Silverrudder wouldn't be the Silverrudder without Henrik.
That is true.
Henrik is just a great guy. He helps us out with data, statistics, information, drone pictures.
And next year he will sail in an XP44.
That's true.
Yeah.
We've actually... We were on board Henrik's boat yesterday, and we've promoted him to administrator of our website because he's such a cool guy. He helps so much.
He definitely
is. That was the start of the extra large boats. Let's get on the starting line. It looks like Peter Vred wins the start, and then followed by the X412 lovely classic boat with a big bowsprit. Henrik is not going to be pleased about that at all. You can go slightly to the right, please, Fleming.
Could be fun to focus on the battle they have there.
Yeah, look at this.
55
the
and
huge, great, big. Can you go further to the right, Fleming? To the right,
yeah.
There's a fun
battle here.
Yeah, that's perfect. Shami, which is Michael Anderson in his X55, has just totally covered Henrik in his Jørgensen in his X43, he's not going to be pleased about that at all. So, and remember, in this race you're not allowed to luff. We race in accordance with the collision avoidance rules. In any other race, if a boat tries to overtake you like that, you'd ram him up to starboard and make him head him into the wind. Yeah. But you're not allowed to do anything at all. You just have to stand on.
Yeah, actually, I talked to Henrik on the X4.3 before the start. He told me that he will be in Lillebælt at 9 o'clock in the evening. He hopes
okay.
So.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
So. Yeah. He's and he was happy for that. He think he will get around this year.
Yeah.
Because sometimes there's a lot of wind in Silverrudder, and sometimes there's no wind.
Yes.
But this year it should be good.
That's a 4.3, X4.3.
No, this one's
it's a loafer.
Okay.
In his loafer 45, the brand new boat.
Okay.
And he had trouble unfurling his code zero, and it's just simply because he didn't have enough tension on his halyard.
Yeah.
With a code zero, which is a bottom up reef, you just simply have to have plenty of tension. Look at this. This is nice. You can't actually see on the picture, but. But the Henrik Jørgensen did the only right thing, and it's just carved up to the right to starboard.
Yeah, he's attacking the 55.
Now he's covering the 55.
There you go, and went to windward of the 55. Yeah. And I mean, the X43 is a big, beautiful, chunky boat. But look how small it looks compared to the X55.
Look at this picture here.
Yeah,
that's what racing is all about.
Certainly, if you like X boats, because looking at this picture, there are four or five X boats right there, and between them is the Landmark 43.
Yeah,
with Martin Meridine, who set his Jenica.
Wow.
Perfect. Yeah, thanks for zooming out there. You've got, if you look at this, you've got an X, that's Paul Stiansen with his XP44 to the left, who said in Jenica, and you've got the X412, you've got an X55, an X43 and an X43 and a bit next to it. I mean, if you're an X-boat representative like you are, Torben, you must be proud.
Of course. It melts my heart. I think Norwegian Paul Stiansen made the best start here. He really timed it well.
He's an amazing sailor. He's a really, really good sailor. And I remember in 2018, where the weather was so tough, I mean, he was just a mile ahead of everybody else.
Yeah.
He literally entered port a couple of hours before the next boat. He just really proved that he had endurance and stamina way above anybody else. Notice that he hasn't set a Jenica like everybody else, or Code Zero. He's gone full in, and he's gone for the spinnaker. And that's a lot of sail for one guy. I mean, we're talking, I'm guessing, 250 square meters, I'm guessing. Maybe, probably then. I don't think it can be much less than 250 on an XP44.
And now we can see that we got more wind. So they're really increasing the speed now.
Yeah, you're right, Trolls. It definitely looks like the boats that we can see in the camera here have got much faster than they were in the last start. Good observation there.
And the weather report told us that there should be more wind during the day, or?
Well, no, in fact, the wind is going to increase a little bit during the morning here. But as we get some towards the evening, it's going to start to dissipate a bit. We're going to have less wind, probably around 20, 22 knots. But we mustn't be deceived, because the reason why we don't have much wind in here is because there's so much lee from the shore. I mean, I promise you, there's wind out there.
And then the wind will go in east?
It'll go further to the northeast, yes.
Yeah. And that's good when they are in Fintrude, they've got the wind from the side?
Definitely, because it'll mean they'll have wind on the beam, and they'll be able to put on some jennikers and you know, what we call flying sails, and they'll be able to, some of these boats will be going 15 knots north of Foon, as will the small surfing boats. So they're going to go really, really fast. Now, the small class, they're the guys going to have most fun.
Henrik Jørgensen told me that he hoped he got the current with him in Lillebælt around 9 o'clock in the evening, this evening. So
he's planning to be there at 9 this evening?
Yeah, he said. Well, 9:10.
Yeah. It depends on the current through the Great Belt, I think. I would say that's possibly. It might be a bit ambitious.
But
I'll be there following.
But the current is now going north in the.
The current in the Great Belt, or what?
Yeah.
No, it's going against them, but it'll turn and we'll go with them. So. Well, Bjørn Scheifens there in his brand new Lofa 45 Dexter, a beautiful boat called Silver, has now unfurled his Code Zero. But yeah, Code Zero is just not doing the job with the wind angles that there is at the moment. You just simply have to get out there and get your Jennifer up. If you look at Michael Anderson in his Chamois, notice that he's sailing what we call goose winging it. Yeah, there you go. Perfect picture, Fleming. Look, you see, he's got his mainsail out to starboard.
Looking fantastic.
Yeah. And his code zero to port. Well, in that circumstance, you can use the code zero as like as a flying jib or a jinnicker.
Yeah.
And if you look at Paul Stevenson with his black and white spinnaker there, he's got to slack off a bit to windward. He's going to be flying in a minute. He's got the length and he's got the power. The only boat in front of him looks like it's the Landmark 43 with Michael Meridine. Martin Meridine, I apologize. And that's a really, really fast boat. If you measure the boat on the ORC or IOR, then it's not a fast boat. It gets punished because it is just such a racing machine. But not for not, meter for meter, it's by far the fastest boat out there.
Wow.
And he's a brilliant sailor. I mean, Martin's young, he's fit, and he's really, really sharp, and he's a good guy. He's definitely in a contention for the leading, the first extra large boat to win the race. Unless Michael Anderson Chamy, who just has so much more waterline, if he keeps alert and is aggressive and sails hard, you know, pushes himself, gets the right big sails up there, he obviously has the benefit of having an extra 12-meter or 12-foot waterline.
Yeah, and if you're sailing the X55, you have electric winches, Tom.
Yeah.
Sure. So the bigger the boats are, the more easy is it?
Well, it's easy in terms of the electric winches, yes. But you got to know what you're doing still. But yes, for sure, it is easier.
Yeah, because everything goes wrong. If a sail of that size gets snagged, yes, then you don't need an electric winch for much. You need a doctor because it's such a huge sail. Like I said, I'm guessing that it's 250 square meters that spinnaker there.
The X55 is bigger than 250, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
The one that you can see up there. I mean, it's massive. Yes. Now that's now Chamy isn't carrying a spinnaker. It's the X55.
No, that's true. Yeah.
But. Yeah. Important is that the autopilots the more expensive they are, the better they are. They have more options sailing to the wind. I mean,
surprisingly enough, a lot of the very small boats, the minis, the Seascape 18s, don't carry autopilots, and really? That's why, amongst other reasons, why. When they were called Seascape, first called them the hard bastards. They made films about them racing around Funa, the Silverrudder, and these guys were doing 44 hours, you know, without sleep, without an autopilot, you know, going to the second night and the next full day. Mm. So to answer your question, Halls, there's no doubt that if you've got a decent autopilot, you've got a much, much easier race than if you're not carrying an autopilot or have a small, you know, the small tiller pilots, the Auto Helm 1000s.
Yeah.
To be quite honest with you, they're fine when you're on a reach, but beating against the wind or fully downwind, they're useless. They just don't react fast enough.
No.
And it doesn't matter which make it is, they just can't react fast enough.
But when you put it, I said, 50 degrees to the wind, that's
fine,
what they
pretty
do.
Good. Yeah. They're pretty good. And I say pretty good. That as soon as there's any waves, then they got knocked off course.
Yeah. But I think they are going...
Exactly. I mean, you can adjust the gain. A lot of the guys in the harbor have said, well, I'm having trouble with my autopilot. And I said, check out your configurations. Check out your gain. Check out your response time. Because if your response time is low, the boat will be swaying from one side to the other. And if your gain's too low, when you do, for example, tack, using the tack function, the boat will bear off away much more than 90 degrees. It'll go down to one tire, 10, and then carve up and... You've got to use your autopilot.
I know the Landmark 43. He told me he had a really good autopilot.
There's no doubt. I'm not going to talk about which make is the best, but there's no doubt about it. If you've got a boat of that caliber, you've put the right autopilot, because for shorthanded sailing, it's your best friend.
Yeah.
And I'd say it's impossible to complete this race in a boat of this size without an autopilot, because when you have to jibe the jinnicker of 200 or a spinnaker of 250 square meters, you actually manually have to go up there and move the spinnaker pole. Nobody's there to do it for you.
Ugh.
No kidding. It might be made of carbon,
but
there's just one man and his boat. It's tough going.
But they can have help from land. There's no limit there.
Oh, absolutely not. No help at all. Absolutely no help whatsoever. You mustn't start your engine. You can call your wife if you consider that to be help.
Okay, so you cannot call some big star and get some help there.
Oh, yeah. But sure, you can. No? Can you... You ask.
What do you mean? What do you mean by help from land? You mean somebody to come to help you jibe the spinnaker
on the cell phone and
there are no restrictions. I mean, under normal racing rules, you're allowed to receive no help whatsoever, none whatsoever. And officially and formally, even just receiving messages on your telephone is a breach of the rules. Whereas here, I mean, you can call people, and I guarantee you, these guys are getting calls from their wives and other people's wives and people all night. Hey, remember to stay awake. You know, we're watching you, we're tracking you, which is nice if you consider that to be help. I'll tell you a very funny little story. I think in 2014 when I was racing and there was very little wind, I was up just past North Funen and going to the Keramina Bay, and I was in my Impeller 27, and there was a Banner 30 that I've been racing against, you know, for 30 hours. And my wife said, oh, Dillies with Anders Hansen has now gone 40 degrees to starboard and he's doing 5 knots. Maybe he's found some wind. So I set up a code zero and went 40 degrees to starboard and could only, you know, do about 3 knots. And after an hour and a half, she called me and said, Philip, he's entered into port. He's given up. He has his engine started. So make sure that when you do get help from the outside, it is useful help.
Yeah.
And if my wife's listening in, I love you very much. So going back to the starting line, this is great. You can see the X power there behind it. It looks like the Swedish guy that was aground has either come off the ground or has given up.
Hopefully he's come off, because that was terrible to go back to Sweden after 800 meters.
Oh, a terrible start. I mean, just sailing here, you know, probably sailing something like every day anywhere between 200 and 600 miles. Yeah.
But Philip, is it true that you got some persons to look at the GPS tracking to follow the boats to secure that there's nobody's on ground
or
fell in the water? Or
absolutely, Troels. We have 5 people that are constantly monitoring the sailors throughout the race. Now, they're sitting in a shed down in the harbour, and we've got like what we call team leaders who are responsible. They make the ultimate decisions. They're in contact with the rescue coordination centres if we need to rescue. We've got 3 young people that are taking pro skipper education, so they're yacht masters, and they're at the Oar High School, so they're highly qualified to do this, and they're monitoring them 24 hours a day, looking for deviation in their course, looking for adjustments or changes, unexpected changes in their speed, or if a skipper calls and says he's gone aground, we immediately try and help. So yeah, this is all something that's developed throughout the years, and 2018 was a tough year for us, you know, seeing boats colliding, seeing boats running aground. I mean, thank heavens we've never had a serious accident. We've had material damage, but we've never had a serious personal injury, so, which is fantastic. We're petrified that somebody will have an accident one day. Well, and we acknowledge that it's inevitable, but we want to make sure that when it happens, that we're 100% ready. We've got guys sitting there 24 hours a day.
Yeah? Oh, nice, very nice.
Beautiful. Look at the scenery here.
But we don't have any sun, but we got wind.
We got more and more wind now.
Yeah. But no rain.
That's good.
That's good. For example, a lady's just written to me, and I probably don't have all that much time as we speak here, but there's a lady's written to my husband saying, my husband's track doesn't work, I can't find him. So as soon as we finish here, I'll investigate that, and I'll call this safety group and say, look, this number isn't working, and make sure that you either help him out or investigate why it isn't working. Yeah. Yeah, look, Fleming is just paced over the track. You can see the boats as they come out of the sound, which is amazing. You can see them coming through here on the tracker. You can see the whole bunch of boats still in the harbour. They'll be the multi-hulls, and you can follow them. Espen Snare is in the lead, as you can see on the right-hand side of the screen. Born to Run with Paul Stjernsen, number 2. The 396 Phoenix, that beautiful Lig 48-foot boat, is number 3. And Richard Roth in his XP44 Tsar. So as you can see, you can follow the boats. The last 4 of the, or 5 of the extra large boats have just, well, almost crossed the starting line. So literally 15 minutes after the start started, they're now crossing the starting line.
Yeah, that was late.
Yeah, and then one of them is one of my students called Melde. And Melde's a great guy. He's taking his Master Mariner's license. He's the guy said has circumnavigated with the Silverrudder a couple of times in an X-79 and is now doing so in his dad's steel boat, which weighs 13, 14 tons. So it's so good to see so many different people here racing different types of boats with different levels of ambition. It's great. Drone pictures here from the front of it's not the front of the large boat class, but these are the large boats. I can see that's an Olsen 370 there. That boat you can see in the camera here is a J109 with Andreas. So, and you can see a lot of these boats aren't carrying spinnakers or jennakers, so they're definitely not right at the front of the fleet.
But that's a good thing with Silverrudder, that we have so many different boats, boat types, compared to Fyn Rund, or because we got a lot of German boats here in the race.
Yeah, it's great to have so many nationalities, Troels. I agree with you. And this year we're honored to have 13 different nationalities here. Unfortunately, wow. We had 14, but a lovely guy, Gregory, and unfortunately I can't pronounce his surname, Gregory, who's a Hungarian guy. He sailed the Vegvisir, and unfortunately he broke one of his foils. He's participated in the Silverrudder a couple of times now, so he had to put his boat back on a trailer and tow it home.
But we are around 370 boats starting.
Yeah, 364 boats have started, as far as I recall.
And was 450 on the list?
Yeah, we always allow 450 to enroll. And then, as I showed the participants at the skippers' meeting yesterday, those tickets, the first 420 of them were sold in 27 minutes. That's amazing.
Wow.
And because of the urgency of the fact that, you know, people have to buy a ticket on that day, obviously some people are going to enroll, knowing that they might not actually be able to participate. I hope that makes sense. You know, they say, well, I really want to participate, but I'm not sure if I'm going to, but I better get a ticket anyway. Which
okay.
means that a few tickets get wasted every year. And we'd love to see if we can avoid that. But we believe that the urgency of the Silverrudder, the fact that you have to, you know, enroll on that particular day, is part of the buzz of the event. It's part of the DNA. It's part of making it something quite exceptional.
Yeah.
One guy said to me, you know, this is like by trying to buy a concert ticket for Beyonce. They're all sold within minutes. I think that's exaggerating.
But that is the limit, Philip. You can have around 400 boats in the harbor before the start. Is that why you can perhaps have 500 people on the line, but you don't want it?
I don't know what the limit is, Troels. I think that if we left the registration open, it would take away the urgency. And yeah, we might end up with 600 tickets. But we have to be able to handle it, you know. Not one single person involved in the Silverrudder gets a cent for doing so. We're all volunteers. And personally, I think I'd probably use somewhere near, I don't know, I don't think I'm exaggerating if I say 500 hours up to the event.
Wow.
The last few days, we don't sleep very many hours. We're really busy. And I'm not sort of playing my violin here, but I'm just saying that we need volunteers to be able to handle.
Yeah, you're
volunteers.
Around 100.
Yeah, 96
volunteers.
Yeah. And you know, some people stand at the bar for a few hours. Some people erect tents. Some people are responsible for the food. Some people are responsible for, you know, for websites and stuff and accounts. And yeah, we get a million questions from people. And how to? Where do I park?
And what is the chairman Ole Ingman doing?
Oh, Ole, don't underestimate Ole. I mean, he might not be as visible now as he used to be, but he's very active. He really is.
Yeah.
Ole is very much involved with the sponsors, with the local community, with the municipal, making sure that we get permission to have the whole harbour filled. You know, Ole has a huge amount of energy. And yeah, I mean, Ole is not 21 anymore, but don't underestimate the fact that he maybe has taken a secondary role, and maybe he might not be the front figure anymore, but he's very much still in charge of the Silverrudder, very much so.
And the town Swindor is happy for having Silverrudder?
They love it, Troels. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, look, we're out of season, it's the middle of September, and there's not one single Airbnb hotel room or bed and breakfast available at all.
Wow.
I spoke to a German guy who arrived 3 days ago, and he said he's so pleased to be here, but his wife and children have to stay at a hotel in Odense to be able to stay here and watch the event. So that's the downside, obviously. But it's become popular, and we love arranging this, and we love organizing it. But there are a lot of hours involved. So going back to your question, will we expand the race? I don't think so. It's certainly not an ambition for us. We don't really see why we should. It's not we don't do this for the money. There's really very, very little profit in this at all. You know, we've retained the.
I like that. I like that much.
We've charged the fee has remained the same for 3 years now, €161, 1,200 krona. It's nothing.
Mm.
Look at what you're getting. We're getting the.
You get a T-shirt or what?
Well, it depends. You can earn a T-shirt. Nobody gets a T-shirt.
No. the famous one.
The famous T-shirt. We mustn't change things too much. We tried changing. Remember a few years ago when Ola decided that people should have a cap? We almost had a revolution.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I circumnavigated Foon for a camp.
Yeah, what's it called? The
finisher t-shirt.
The finisher, yeah.
The Silverrudder finisher t-shirt.
Yeah.
And like some of the guys, the sailors are saying, if you turn up in your sailing club with a finisher t-shirt in Germany or in Switzerland,
you get respect.
Austria, you're amongst the top dog, the top notch. You're not just a sailor, you're a warrior. You're a Silverrudder aficionado. The next race, which is the next start, which is going to start in 10 minutes' time, is the small multi-hulls. And these boats are great. I mean, these are the really, really, these are close to the fastest boats. Obviously, we've got a next start, which is the large multi-hulls, which are even faster. But these boats are going to be tearing up along Funen. But don't overestimate these boats. These boats are great when they can get a bit of slack on their sails. But they're pretty hard to steer as soon as they have to beat. They don't beat as fast, and they have to be very careful not to capsize. You have to be very, very on your toes and slack off the main so that these things don't, what we call, turtle or nosedive. I don't know if you remember back in 2017,
very heavy winds,
we had a trimaran capsize, and that was terrible to watch.
Yeah, I was there.
Yeah.
He was just sailing in his pants, and he got a vest on, yeah.
He was just wearing normal short trousers, and
yeah.
I think he was very surprised.
Yeah.
And he was
not so experienced sailor, so.
No, he hadn't had the boat very long. As far as I remember, he'd only had the boat for a year or so.
Yeah.
And it took everybody by surprise. And that model of boat has a very flat pontoon at the top, so when the boat does nosedive, it finds it very difficult to release the water.
It was a dragonfly, yeah.
You said it, not me. The rest of them are great. They're great boats.
I'm a journalist. I have to say it.
Of course you do.
But I don't show picture of it more anymore.
Don't you? I had one in my slide presentation yesterday. But it's not for the spectacular scene. It's just the fact that it is part of Silverrudder history. And like we talked about before, we've been extremely fortunate not to have any serious accidents here. But if you're putting 350, 60 boats on a starting line, you're going to have some material damage, aren't you, Torben? I mean, you're a boat salesman. You represent a yard. I mean, you're going to have material damage.
I'm sure there will be damage somewhere, at least if the wind picks up. You know as well, you can't sail without small or bigger damages occasionally.
Yeah, I mean, I can see I'm standing here on the starting line looking at one of the trimarans, a small grey, I think it's a Corsair. I remember last year, he just simply clipped a boy in the sound here. He took a boy between one of the two pontoons, and that was his race finished. You know, he'd towed the boat all the way from Germany, which is a terrible shame, but you're going to have navigational errors, and you're going to have material errors. You're going to have miscalculations with regard to navigation. I mean, look at the Swedish guy that took his boat all the way from Sweden and went to ground 800 meters after the start. I mean, that's awful. And unfortunately, there are going to be more of them during the next 48 hours.
Yeah.
What kind of I can't say what kind of damage you experience most often in the X-boats, because they don't damage, do they?
Well, of course they do, but. It's boats that are made for performance cruising also, so they are designed for heavy use, and so I would say it doesn't happen often.
I mean, Richard Holt in his Zion, I don't want to keep talking about that. He's a great guy and he's a good sailor, very good sailor, very experienced. I mean, he put his boat heavily aground, and no boat, regardless of where it's built, doesn't matter if they've got a steel or aluminium frame or they built an epoxy, no boat can handle that kind of treatment. So when we talk about navigational errors or human errors, accidents will happen. Most of these guys are very mentally prepared. They're physically prepared for accidents that might happen. They're all wearing their life jackets. They've all got their safety gear on board. They're all in close communication with shore all the time. So we'd say that they're prepared for the eventualities that might occur.
I'm sure they are prepared. They know that shit happens sometimes, and it costs, yes. But it's like car racing, you know. If you make a mistake, you pay for it. It costs.
Now it's the 5 minutes till the small multi-hulls. Now remember, these are the boats below 28 feet. So we're talking Corsair 760s, Corsair Pulse 600 small boat, a Diam 24, you know, 24 foot catamaran or trimaran is a small boat for 25 knots of wind. Got a few Dragonfly Sports, very fast performance boats, Dragonfly 800s, which are the old series. And then, you know, the Farriers F82s always surprise us every single year. They do very well. Yeah. So we've got about 13 registrations. We've got about 7 or 8 boats starting in this start here.
Yeah, a very little start compared to the others.
They need a bit more space now, don't they, Tolls?
Yeah.
And these boats can't just luff up or bear away as other boats can. I remember they're sort of probably 2.5 times the width of the
normal. Now we have about round, 8 knots of wind or around that.
That was the 4-minute mark for the small multi-hull start. It's going to be an exciting start here. Some of the size of the sailors in this race, amongst others, Lars Kempfer in his Dragonfly 800. He won the Round Denmark race, which he races with his son, and he's participated in this race year after year. Anders Brandt in his in his Dragonfly 25 has been a few times before, as has Peter Lang in his Diam 24 trimaran. And there are some exceptionally experienced.
Oh, the former Olympic sailor, Peter Lang, yeah.
Indeed.
From Skærbæk,
exactly.
yeah.
Been a bit quiet on that account because he hasn't sort of voiced up and said he wanted to be interviewed, so we've just let him arrive.
Race.
He's sailing a Diam 24 trimaran called, his name's called Diam 24.
Yeah, yeah, he won the bronze medal in 2012 in the 49er. I was there, yeah. Wow, nice wind now. You would like to be there, Torben Conner?
Oh yeah, I would love to be there.
So wouldn't. And which boat do we want? Which X-Shaft do you want to be on?
to be honest. Right now I wished I had my my good old X40.
Oh yeah.
I sold last year. I really loved that boat and it performed so well and was comfortable and nice and I really.
But you told me when you sailed your Jennifer, it was a bit special what you did with your spinnaker pole.
I used the pole because I got a Jennifer but no bowsprit, and if I wanted to go deep I just used the spinnaker pole and basically sail it as a spinnaker.
But then you had to jibe it. Was
it was a tricky thing to jibe it, but it took some time but it worked. And it probably looked funny, but it worked.
Yeah. Yeah, you're normally sailing in Skive.
Well, in the Limfjord.
Limfjord, yeah.
I do. I sail actually quite a bit around this area as well. I really love cruising in the south of Fyn. I think it's one of the top sailing areas in the world.
Yeah, I talked to Crane Nielsen, CEO from X-Yachts, your boss, and he told me that the Danes are buying a lot of X-Yachts for the moment, the last 2 years. Can you tell me why? Is it the corona?
I know why they buy an X-Yacht.
Yeah, but
I don't.
He told me that the Germans and the Danes are really buying X-Yachts for the moment.
That's true.
More than usually.
Denmark has become our biggest market in the world, which is very unusual. And frankly spoken, we don't know why.
1 minute to start.
Yeah, we do know why they buy X-Sharks, but not why people buy so many boats.
Yeah.
Other than sailing is wonderful.
You've got an X-Yacht on the way, haven't you?
It's true. Yes, I do. And I have ordered an X4.3, the new model that is coming next year, and I'll have it around 1st of May. And of course, I'm very excited.
Yeah, I can imagine you are.
Yeah.
So, what have you done to the 4.3? What alterations have you made for the new generation?
It's got a wider aft, a stern section. It's got a bit higher mast, more sail in general. And there's small modifications and small changes that actually make the boat look quite a bit better, but also perform a bit better.
So perhaps we will see you in the start here with your new boat or what? One day.
That was the start of the small multi-hulls there. and you can see that they're well behind the starting line. It's difficult to see with the camera shot that we're showing you at the moment, but I would estimate that these two boats that are in front are at least, I don't know, 50 meters behind the starting line, which just goes to prove, you know, these guys know that they're in for a long.
Yeah, even the Olympic sailor is 200 meters from the line. Yeah.
Coming into the picture in just a second. He's coming out from behind the trees there.
What color has the boat?
I think it's the one with the Danish
Danish
flag and the
in the sail.
The mainsail.
Can you imagine sailing that far in such an open boat? Look at he
certainly not
exposed for wind and water and
primer in there. No, I certainly can't, but I think he's probably made of a different stock than I am.
Me too.
And there's some of the guys, André Michelin, which I have huge respect for, and he has been a transat sailor and mini sailor, and those guys are tough. I mean, he says that when you take an Olympian and put him in a race like this, yeah, he might have to spend the first few hours adapting, or first couple of hours adapting to the type of boat, but within a very, very short time, they find where the wind is, they find the counter currents, they find, you know, the benefits along the coastline. They're just so tuned and trained. Yeah. Their physical and mental training is just way ahead, way beyond the rest of us.
They're also fighting with the current.
Yeah, but I mean, obviously a boat with no displacement or very little displacement like this is not going to be affected by the current to the same extent, but the water moves at the speed that it moves.
Yeah.
They don't have much draft, so their benefit is that they can go quite close to shore.
And Philip, we don't see so many fights in the start, and that's the reason for that.
I think it's also something to do with the fact that these boats aren't as
maneuverable. Also the other boats, I mean, is that the rules
remember, these boats are racing in accordance with the collision avoidance rules, so you're not allowed to suddenly, you know, come
bluff up
another boat or bearing down on another boat. The rules say when one boat has to give way, the other one must maintain course and speed.
Wow.
And you can't maintain speed if the wind drops, but you can't start changing course. You have to maintain that course until the other boat has passed you. So what Henrik Jørgensen did before, by waiting until Andersen Chamik had passed him, was, you know, going hard up to starboard. It was a really clever move, because that way you can get free air.
But in another race, under DH, for instance, then you could luff him up.
Yeah, absolutely. They'd be much more aggressive.
But that's not allowed here.
Not at all, no. She's sent into the with the Danish flag at the top. That's Peter Lang, the ex-Olympian, in his Dime 24. Just got out of the picture there. He's furthest to windward, which surprised me a little bit. It's always tempted to come further into the wind, you know, to reach if you're going very deep to get some more speed. These boats are dead slow when they go dead downwind. These boats are not made for going dead downwind. They need a little bit of reach. They need to be able to use their genikers and their reachers, their codes, in order to accelerate.
It must be hard to sail these boats. It must be very cold to sit out there and on the pontoon.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
I've got a friend who has an absolutely gorgeous yellow a boat called Flexodus, a gorgeous trimaran, and his wife has pretty much stopped sailing with him because she says, I'm tired of being cold all the time. When they beat against the wind, they do 12 knots. Downwind, they're doing 15 knots on a normal day.
But they, I hope they had an autopilot.
I certainly think they do, don't you?
Yeah, but the smaller of them, I don't know.
The thing is, they're not only cold, they're also wet.
Yeah.
In Peter's boat, there's no place to get
to hidden
clothes.
No.
Change clothes or anything.
Yeah, I'm wondering where he's got his gear. He's got his lunchbox. And he's going to be around so fast, he's not going to need a lunchbox.
But look how fast he's going in the right side of
the with a flag on, on the sail.
Yeah. With the Danish
and which
top.
Boat is it? Is it?
The Diam 24.
I think he's in the right position there.
Yeah, but I'm quite intrigued to see that none of these guys, or very few of them, are sitting Jennikers. There's one of them. You know, they've just got so much boat speed with their mains alone. Look at the flat tops on their mainsail, especially Peter's with the Danish flag there. and the Dragonfly 25 Performance behind them as well. Got huge grey big tops, what they call flat tops, on the top of their mainsails to get as much sail area at the top, in the height at the top of the mast. Beautiful picture. I mean, the definitely the wind has increased a little bit, and perhaps the current has reduced a little bit as well, which means that we don't get to follow to see them. And I don't know if you guys saw, but there was a dolphin that just popped out of the water.
It's a small whale.
The famous one.
And this one actually is a dolphin. It's called Dylan.
Really?
Yeah, and it's been in Svendborg for about a year and a half, 2 years now.
I just saw it.
Did you see it?
Yeah, sure.
Have you not read about it? They call it Dylan.
Dylan.
And it's become a huge, great big tourist attraction here, which is great if anybody was watching this from home.
But Philip, do you know a lot of people on the race here? Do you know what they are eating? What are they?
Dolphins. No.
No.
I'm sorry,
no.
I couldn't help myself.
Yeah, have they prepared some warm dishes?
Some of them have. These guys haven't. I guarantee you, these guys are not. And neither. I know. The Seascape 18s.
Yeah.
Torben might have. Maybe he's got a nice portion of spaghetti bolognese. Yeah. To be quite honest, that's where the big boats have a much easier race than the small boats. I mean, you imagine sitting in with Klaus Van Messen in his CB66. I mean, he's badass. And looking at these hard bastards in the Seascape 18s, I don't mean to swear and be rude, but I guarantee you...
They don't get warm food.
They won't have a warm cup of coffee or anything warm until they get in 40 hours' time. But the big boats will, and I certainly know that when I raced, I had like portion-packed cold lasagna or something with some protein.
Oh, yeah. Smart.
Or things that would give me the high energy. I also would make sure that I have music, you know, for the long hauls where the wind starts to drop. You're going to be there for hours on end. Keeps you stimulated. You also have to make sure that you don't have something which is too mind-lulling, so you end up being like, you know, dozing off. Andras was saying that early today, it's really important to have, you know, remind yourself, trim, trim, trim. Put a big sticker in front of you where it says trim question mark. Are you optimized at the moment? Are you close to target speed? It's easy to just sit in your boat, set your Jenica, and cruise along at half speed, where you might have been able to set your spinnaker or your A2 or something with more power in it. But you asked me about food, and I'm sorry, I sidetracked.
That's not dry food.
Preparation is important. No, it's not dry food. I mean, maybe some of these guys are pouring some boiling water onto a portion of cup noodles, but cup noodles don't get you very far in a race like this.
But a warm soup in the evening must be important to them all.
Yeah. Well, you know,
I'm sure a guy like Mikael Andersen in his X55 has got a microwave oven. He could even make popcorn if you wanted.
I thought he's got a sauna and a billiard table on board.
I don't know about that one, but I'm sure he's not going to freeze.
Drinking Amarone.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure he's going to have a... I'm not saying he's not a tough guy. It's a tough race, no matter who's doing this race, but it certainly is easier in a boat with a water line of 13 meters than it is...
And here we see the dragonfly near the shore.
Is that Jens? Yeah, I think... let me just see the number.
Jens Skorning.
Picture now. Let me just move category on my computer here.
Dragonfly 28, or is it?
Peter Corning, Jens.
Yeah.
Peter Corning is the son of Jens Corning, who drives the Dragonfly yacht in Denmark. So it's Peter sailing. What was it? 28.
Yeah, he's. I moved the cursor a bit there. Yeah. He's in a Dragonfly 28.
Yeah.
Sport,
Peter.
It's in a performance.
Yeah, of course.
The latest generation.
Yes.
They have the 28 and then the sport and the performance, and the difference is very much the hull shape.
Yeah.
The pontoons on the sides.
So Jens is not in the race, or?
No, I don't believe he is this year. No, he's not this year, no. So we've got Peter in his Dragonfly performance, and you've got, obviously, you've got an old legend from the race, which is Jan Andersen in his Marlin 33, which is used to be called Black Marlin only, but it's now actually for sale and being produced on the market under the brand name Marlin 33. Which is exciting news, and I know that he's actually sold one recently. You've got Alan Tunnesen here, which has also been with us many times, famous multi-hull sailor here in Denmark. It's going to be a tight race. Christian Kreuger is definitely in this course. A 31 RS is also a contender, but I reckon I'm still vouching for the mile in 33 to win overall. But Jan is not only an exceptional person and an exceptional boat builder and designer, he's also a really, really gifted sailor. And he's got stamina, he's got endurance. You don't underestimate him. I'm not sure if Alan and Brian Tunison are father and son.
No, they're brothers. And I'm just thinking because I think one of them is a former windsurfer, and I raced with him in the old days. Mm. He's quite a good windsurfer too.
Yeah.
So that was Alan Tunison, I think. Mm-hmm. So that's
what
funny
kind of
that
boards
they
was he racing?
That was back in the time where we were using formula boards, I think.
Slalom
formula
course or
slalom and formula course. And course racing and slalom.
How long ago are we talking about, Tom?
I don't even remember.
Don't tell me.
Probably maybe almost 20 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been windsurfing for 42 years, so.
Have you?
So I don't remember.
Remember who was when?
No,
and where.
No.
Yeah. Are you still an active windsurfer?
Yes, I am. Hmm? I'm foiling. Yeah. Actually, since I learned foiling 3 years ago, I haven't touched the normal board.
Oh really?
Foiling is wonderful. It's fantastic.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
But you never went on to the kite surfing board.
I learned it and I think it's fun, but I just like windsurfing much better. Yeah, and it's more physical too. So I like this feeling when you've been out the whole day that you're really, you can feel your body is under pressure. Yep.
Okay. Look at the pictures on the screen here. You can see there's the. It looks like the drone might have frozen the screen, but here you go. You've got the. This is the extra large start that we just saw started before. We've got the 402, 412s there. A little bit too much light on the exposure there, but leaving the sound here, you've got the small trimarans already out there by Tour.
Yeah.
And about 17 minutes to the final start of the Silverrudder 2021. And I can see a Dragonfly 28. Performance hiding behind the trees here. And just in front on the picture here you've got a Gansole, and I can see that's the Luffe 440, I believe. Back to the trimarans. That's beautiful, isn't it? They look like little UFOs.
Yeah.
But no, none of them, not many of them have got kites up. Just one of them, which is jibing, the rest just going downwind, going deep. Which is actually surprises me a bit that they're using such a conservative start.
I think already around the corner down there, they're almost heading upwind. Yeah.
You're definitely right. I mean, it's an 80 degree turn to port. But
yeah, it is.
I sort of assumed that some of the boats, like the big guys that have started today, would still set up a Jenica. But maybe the fact that the speed increase isn't that great with the small, very, very light trimarans. I got to be honest, I'm not a multi-hull expert at all.
So, Philip, when they are in the harbour again, will they have a little party or anything this year? During the corona, it was closed down.
Well, not really, no. Now, this event, it's very much about sailing. It's very much about sailing around Foon. We have the great skipper's presentation, the great meal there, but it's also something to do with the fact that the boats come back to Svendborg.
You
know,
tired.
We're not only tired, but there might be 24 hours between. I remember the first and second time there was the Silverrudder. There was a party, and I remember having completed it in year 2013, and I'd been awake for 36 hours, and somebody said, "Come and have a beer." I had one beer, and I fell under the table. I was absolutely dead. I thought I'd been buried and dug up again, and there was somebody inviting me to a party, and quite honestly, these guys are dead meat.
Yeah.
And the real heroes here
get a hot meal.
Yeah, well, there's sandwiches and there's food here that they can see when they come back. But it's not about partying. And I know that the Vigvisir had a huge party and three bands, which was impressive. But I also heard that the majority of the sailors were lying down in the boat sleeping.
Here's the dolphin.
There he is, yeah. Flaming. Can you see the dolphin here?
Just in front of the dragonfly, the famous dolphin.
Dele, yeah. Just came up just in front of the boat.
Torben, you're a real dolphin spotter. You should move to town. I've got a funny story. One of the participants in an X79 called Sigaline, lovely girl who works as a teacher at a World Training Academy. She's sailing her dad's X-79. He is like Mr. Dolphin all year round, 365 days a year. He goes out paddling and supping. Exactly, yes, Patil. Well, you've interviewed him, haven't you, Tolls?
Yeah.
He's a very cool guy.
And he's a keen sailor. Well, he goes out every single day in his wetsuit.
Yeah.
And he goes out paddling.
Out is in his sport, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. He's become sort of like Mr. Dolphin. He's got a Facebook site.
For 1 year ago, they had a problem because some of the motorboats were hunting the Dille and making fun with it. And then they had some rules now to prevent that.
Yeah. The Dille Protection Act.
Okay.
Just kidding. You know, yeah, everybody loves Dille except the local fishermen because Dille eats a lot of trout. You can't catch a sea trout in Svendborg anymore.
It's just next to the.
Is it next to the dragonfly?
Just next to the dragonfly now.
You probably got it on film then.
Yeah. It was.
So those of you watching here, looking in here, not only do we have the world's greatest single-handed sailing, we also have a dolphin safari live for you. Yeah, look, he's stopping and pointing. Look, there's a dolphin in. And if those of you didn't know, those of the people participating didn't know there was a dolphin in Svendborg, it must have come quite a surprise. I mean, it's huge. It's like 2.5 meters long. Yeah. It's not just...
And for people outside Denmark or in the south of Europe, it's nothing special, probably.
It's not uncommon, no.
It's not uncommon, no. But for us here in Denmark,
it's huge.
It is.
It's massive.
It's
big. It's very special.
Yeah.
But it's very social fish.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
On the right side.
These guys are going to forget to start. They're hunting.
They don't care about.
They're going to be disqualified for giving Dille for harassing our dolphin. Yeah. Well, back to great pictures here from the drone. Look, yeah, that guy has noticed that his Genoa is wrapped around his head today. Back to the tries.
And this is the last start here.
This is the last start, Trolls, exactly. Yeah, in 30 minutes, that's the final start. And once we've finished here, we've packed our gear, I'll be heading home. And on the way there, I'll be going past the security team, you know, talking to them about how they'll be tracking the boats. And I've assigned them a little job this year. So every 3 hours, I'll be receiving an update on the top three boats in every single category. And I'll be receiving an update on which boats have decided to retire from the race. So we're constantly on top of it. As opposed to last year, this year, when a boat does retire from the race, his marker on the track system will become a different color. It'll change color. It'll go from being, you know, bright orange or yellow to being black or gray. So they'll still be visible, but you'll know that they've retired from the race. Huh?
I think it's Peter Lang. Oh, Peter Corning, of course. Yeah. Who's
indeed it is, as Peter
the 28,
the son of Jens Corning, who is as you said, Torben, the founder and owner of Corning Yachts. And I remember when the 28 won the Silverrudder back in 2018. Do you remember that? It was gold, and they transported the whole boat to the boat show, and on the side of it said Silverrudder winner 2018 at the boat show. Incredible.
Yeah.
It was like a brownie gold cutter, fantastic. Yeah. And they're good-looking boats. I mean, they're so different to anything else on the water.
So he will have a big fight with his father in the dragonfly.
I don't think Jens is in the race. I just saw Peter looking in his binoculars to the fleet up there.
No, he was looking for the dolphin, Torben.
No, but he was looking, of course, to... for the other trimarans and to see how the wind is going to be down there around
he's
the
checking
corner.
Out to see whether they can set head sails or whether they can increase by staying further to windward. And don't kid yourselves, I mean the tactics are so important here, and if he can get a decent start, if he can get, you know, half a mile ahead of the other boats as they come out of the sound, he'll be out there in the clear wind much sooner than the rest of the boats.
Yep.
Look there.
Yeah, 10 minutes to the start, the last start here in Silverrudder, 2021.
And the boat that we can see in the camera here is Jakob Drudemassen in his Dragonfly 28 Performance, which is a funky looking boat, you know, a great lovely colour. And that's the Performance, and I don't know how much you can see, but the top of the pontoons is completely round now, you know. So if you look at the front end of the port pontoon, it used to be flat, which meant when the boat did nosedive, it would be very difficult for the boat to release the water. There's like a suction or vacuum effect. But having completely round, the boat, a bit like a submarine, you know, rises out of the water, cutting the water free. And also you can see that the pontoons have a, one could say, an opposite shape as they used to. They're narrower at the top than they are at the bottom, which means there's more buoyancy, much more righting moment on the pontoons.
That's true.
Yeah. You can't see him at the moment, but Jan Andersen in Black Marlin has appeared, and he's sort of dauntingly fast. He comes out onto the water, and black sails, black hull. He just looks like a full-blooded stallion compared to the rest of them, doesn't he, Torben?
Yeah, it's very...
Yeah, he just look there. He's, he just look, he looks wicked. Mm. And even just looking at his the water around the hull, he just looks faster than everybody
else.
He's
got the guy who got the record around the
thing. Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, yes.
In, do you remember the time?
Or? 2015, I think he got the record first time. But he's won every year.
It was another boat. It was the wooden boat.
In well, no, he's done it in this boat as well, I believe. Okay, I'll go in and look on my website and have a look at the the record times.
Yeah.
But I know that in 2018, where it was very windy, he didn't start. He went onto the course, checked out the wind, and he said, "Nope. This is just too much wind. I'm not going to wreck my boat. I'll go back into the port, the marina," which is a bit surprising. But you know, it certainly is. He has the making of an extremely good sailor, and he knows exactly where his limits are.
Yeah, he's a local guy from Ballinhaun, not far from here.
That's right. And don't kid yourselves. He's a very good sailor. I mean, he's done round Scotland. You know, he's done all kinds of huge races. If he goes out of the water in his local waters and says this is too much wind, then there's too much wind. So,
but he's also having a holiday in his boat.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. He puts his boat on a trailer.
Yeah, sailing in Norway.
That's right. Goes to Norway. Goes to Croatia. Mm. I can see you asked whether or not he's the record holder. Of course he is. I mean, Jan Andersen won in 2019 in Black Marlin. He went. He said, "I want to try and get around in 15 hours." He got around in 15 hours, 1 minute and 5 seconds. So he's got a race, a record to break. Anders Bastiansen, who is now racing in a Melgus 24, has the record in the small multi-hulls of 16 hours and 04 minutes. I mean, that's amazing. That's only an hour slower than Black Marlin, which is a much more powerful boat. Paul Stiansen in his XP44, born to run, 19 hours and 10 minutes in 2018. And Andreas Rode in his JPK38 has the large boat record, Ratsfats, 19 hours 02. And I know that Wolfram Heibeck is gunning for that. He wants that record in his Open 40 Black Maggie because he's the record holder in the medium class. It was then called an Open 32, but then he chopped the boat in the middle and extended it by 8 feet, so it's now 40 foot long, just within the large class. And I know that the JPK owner, JPK 38, Andreas Rode, he's not participating this year because he's damaged his boat, so it'll be exciting to see whether his record will be taken. The conditions are not perfect with this countercurrent. Franz Schollmeier in the small has a record of in his Field France, which is an S850, and he again, fantastic conditions. In 2015, five of the records were taken. The wind was right, the current was right, a lot of slack on the sheets, so those records are going to be very hard to beat. He got around in his S850 in 20 hours and 23 minutes. And final info here is Morten Bogacki in his Pogo 2 also got the record in his boat called Mojo in 2015, 23 but hours 06.
But Philip and Torben, do you think we will have a new record this year?
Well, I think you know better, Philip, but it does. It's not likely, is it?
No, I don't.
With light winds.
There's too little wind in here. These guys are wasting half an hour in here, which is really expensive. Mm. They're gonna have countercurrent a lot of the time as they go in the beginning up through the Great Belt. And once they get slack on the sheets, I reckon some of the boats will go from Funthul to the entrance of the Little Belt. I'm guessing 3.5 hours. And I've done it in Ulva in 6 hours as record, I think, or 5 hours. I mean, they're going to be screeching along. So there is time to break. If the current is with them going through the Little Belt and they don't have to lay there, but I don't think so. We'll see.
It's all about if there is any wind in the night.
Yeah, or very much.
Yeah.
Black Marlin's new rib. Black Marlin Racing, they've entered Black. Jan Andersen has entered into a contract with a company selling the boats, manufacturing them. I know that he sold one, which is being... I know that the new owner has arrived here in Svendborg to watch the start, so he's going to be keen to see Jan Andersen performing well. Yeah. I mean, but looking at the boat, there, it looks mean, doesn't it? Yeah. Looks like a great boat.
This looks like something has come here to win. Even though he only sailed 6 miles to get here. Jan's a great sailor. He crews a very small boat on the very local race here. That's 5 minutes to the start for the last Silverrudder 2021 start, the 10th jubilee of the Silverrudder. 5 minutes to start for the large multi-hulls. And that's multi-hulls of 28 feet and above.
And what happened if they are too early over the line?
If they cross the starting line too early, unlike all other regattas where you can just, or you have to, turn back and cross the starting line and restart, here you're automatically penalized by 30 minutes.
Okay.
And if a boat hasn't crossed the starting line 60 minutes after its starting signal is sounded, the boat is registered as did not compete, so it didn't start.
Wow.
Yeah, that's tough going.
It will not happen for you, Torben.
Well, you never know. But when I watch the starts here, I'm actually a bit surprised how far away from the start line of course they know it's a long race and it doesn't make sense to make an early start, but I think
they're
some
more conservative.
I think so.
Yeah.
I would say a bit careful.
Well, you know, it's odd. I think this is probably the third time I'm saying this during this presentation this morning. People said, how can you start 134 boats on the line? And it's great to see, you know, expert sailors like you saying, well, I'm surprised. I am surprised. And that's why we no longer split the starts as we did in 15, 16, 17.
But now you're sailing
another direction.
Yeah.
Yeah, the starting line's a bit wider. We don't have the bridge to battle against. I mean, at least we are this year.
So we'll never see the Silverrudder going starboard round?
Oh, yeah, we can definitely see the Silverrudder going the other way.
Okay.
In certain conditions, you know, if the weather conditions speak for it, if in very heavy winds, for example, in heavy westerly winds, where we would be very concerned about having the boats round in the north of Fyn, the wind against them, you know, 40 knots of wind, they would definitely send them the other way. But then we would probably move the start to the second option, which is out at Christiansminde, which is
on the other side of the bridge. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. About 3 miles west of the bridge.
Smart.
Yeah. Yeah, we can see the tracker on the screen here, and you can see Espen Snar is leading the boats. Unfortunately, I can't move the screen. Yeah, he's leading at least the extra large boats. And I can find the track record on my computer.
With Jan Müller in Dream On. Yeah, he's third.
Yes.
And then
Born to Run with Paul Christiansen. Those guys are going to have a hell of a fight. They're going to be a hell of a race. And at least downwind, I think probably Espen Snar has a really good chance, because I think that boat will surf before Dream On and Born to Run. But I'm not sure. It's definitely the boat which is lightest and be able to come out the water fastest.
No, but he's not in that race. That's extra large.
Oh, no.
We're talking about the CEO of X-Yachts, Krenbrink Nielsen, and he's in the large keelboats, large section. So a couple of minutes before the final start.
Yeah, a couple of minutes to go before the start.
And Phil, we can see some helpers from the Rudkøbing rescue team.
Yeah, that's right. They're from
the every year.
Coordination center.
Yeah.
And you know, they're all set up. As you can see, they've got helmets on. They've got their fluorescent uniforms on, ready to help out anybody in distress. And it's great, they come here every single year and help us out. Fortunately, we don't need them. One minute to start. That's not a contender.
No, it's not.
Unless it's a Jenica, we can see, yeah. So they're here to help us out every in case it should be necessary. And one of them looks very bored, which is great for us. We want to see as few incidents and accidents as possible. And I don't know, I can see some boats entering to the sound from the east. I'm not sure if it's both sort of had damage or they're motoring back. This has definitely got to be one of the most peaceful starts we've had. I mean, there's been wind, there's been countercurrent. Unfortunately, we've had very few incidents, which is exactly what we want. So if you're thinking about whether this is a race for you. There's only one way to find out and try it. I know a lot of people come to Svendborg in the starting hours of the event. Okay, here we go. We're back on the large multi-hulls here, bearing away down the starting line. You can see this one here, the T31 Farrier. It's really, really fast, the 435 there. And I'm surprised to see the
black. Jan is coming.
Yeah, here's Jan Andersen in his black Marlin, ripping along. And he's got a normal head sail, and then a Genoa. He's not, surprisingly, he's not put a code zero up, but looks like it's a small, very small code or something that he's set there. He's not set a Genica. The only boat that's set a Genica is that Farrier at the front of the fleet, the Farrier, or the Corsair 31, I mean. And there's one boat right up there under the, the coastline over there, who was a bit surprised that there was no wind there and suddenly found himself probably about 5 to 7 minutes away from the starting line. And Jan Andersen is working hard. I can see he's working on his sheets and his halyards, holding his tiller at the same time. He's not got his autopilot activated. Can you see that? So he's holding his tiller in his left hand whilst he's running the sheets in the other. But you can see even now he's starting to accelerate, go much faster than the other boats in his start. And look at the way the boat's further to windward. The boat that was in the lead there has now completely stopped due to the lee from the coastline. And Jan has done the smart thing and stayed further out in the sound. And yeah, there might be more current, but there's just so much more wind which outweighs the disadvantage of the counter current.
Isn't it the old dragster we see from Aarhus?
Yeah, it is indeed. Yeah, the boat that hasn't crossed the starting line there is the old dragster.
Yeah, there we got dragster with
here is with
new mast and new sails.
With Einar Kjær on as new owner, a one-off trimaran, just there to there at the top of the picture next to the jury boat. And once he gets some slack on his sails, that's a really, really fast boat, isn't it, Tolls?
Yeah. It capsized some years ago in Palbyfynkorp, I think.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Yeah. Well, that was red back then, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was flipped over.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. I mean, you've got to be so fast to slack off in the sheets on a multi-hull. If you're not on top of it all the time, then the boats have a very slight tendency to nosedive. Like I said, I'm definitely not a multi-hull expert, but they have their Achilles tendon. You can see the red Dragonfly 28 performance there. Sport has just unrolled his code. And Black Marlin, you know, he's not exactly tearing along, but he's certainly leading the fleet of large multi-hulls. And he's bigger than the other boats, and he's just so much more powerful. Dragsters has also unfurled his code zero. But as they come away, they're going to find that they're going to need to possibly have a little bit more head sail. It'd be interesting to see whether they do, in fact, set a Jenica, or they decide to just, you know, cruise easily for the first half mile out of the sound here. And our local dolphin Dille is entertaining everybody by being right
nice.
There. And, yeah, he's right, and he's jumping out of the water. It's right in front of our cameras here, which is nice. I need to go.
Here we see the small multi-hull is fighting, and the bigger ones are here.
Yeah,
and thank you for Torben Corning for commentating here.
Yeah, Torben Corning's about to jump into the X-Power and follow the fleet for the first few miles out to the Tuor reef.
But Philip, what do you think about the start this year?
Well, like you and Torben, I'm surprised that the people haven't been more aggressive. I think perhaps the sailors have been cautious about the current, didn't realize how much counter current there was, don't you think?
Yeah, yeah.
But the start is brilliant. I mean, 360 of the 450 enrolled boats starting is amazing. I mean, yeah. We're absolutely overjoyed to see this many boats.
I think it's very positive because we have some wind this year.
Yeah, yeah. And also we've had good weather up to the event tolls. We haven't, like previous years, had either completely calm weather or stormy weather. So everybody has been able to, you know, get here on time.
Yeah.
People that have had their boats ready and no damage and stuff have been able to get.
Are they here typically 2 days before the race?
Well,
or
some of the boats are here 10 days before the race.
Wow.
About 20 boats arrived after Vigvisir. They sailed them straight down here and said, okay, that way my boat's parked here, ready to go. And a lot of people came down literally 3 or 4 days before. But a surprising number arrived yesterday. This is the first year where we've had about 100 boats starting at the very last minute, or arriving at the very last minute, which is superb.
Wow.
Yeah, so surprising how many boats, you know, turn up at the very last minute, but it's a little bit like starting boats. I mean, I hardly dare to say this, but there's a try, one of the large tries, which hasn't crossed the starting line yet. And, you know, it's literally 6 minutes since the start went, and he's about 300 meters from the starting line, so he's got a bit of catching up to do. But it could be things like surprise, you know, leaving the port or couldn't get his engine started, and it doesn't take much if you end up being delayed. It's just tough going. This is a race which isn't won in the first few minutes. It's won by endurance and just hanging on in there for hours. But look at this boat towards has just started. Can you see there's a boat starting?
Yeah, the green line? One or
no, the gray one here. That boat, that's
it's a, in the a race?
Easy, well, it has got the number 146 on the side.
Oh, it must be 2-3 hours late.
Well, he's not allowed to start. 60 minutes after,
wow.
You're disqualified.
Yeah.
146, I'll just check him out. I mean, a boat that starts that late obviously can't be regarded as having started. So to answer your question, it's been a fantastic start. The fantastic start to the event. We're going to be following these boats every day, every hour, every third hour. We'll be sending an update. The safety group will be uploading information on the progress of the boats and where they are on the way around Funen. Follow the tracker on Track Silverrudder 2021, and you can follow minute by minute the progress of the boats. Stay tuned. We'll also be posting information on Facebook and on our website, but primarily Facebook. That is our primary source of information. And thanks for listening in. It's been a pleasure to have you here on the starting line of the Silverrudder 2021. And I can happily log off now, at least from the camera, because the last boat has crossed the starting line.
Yeah, thank you very much also for me.
Yeah, thanks very much for coming, Trolls. Appreciate very much that you come back every year and help us out with this. It's great to have experts on the sideline that can tell us what's going on in the Danish fleet and the German fleet for what has now become the biggest race in Northern Europe and by far the biggest single-handed race in the world.
In the world, yeah. Must be, Philip.
Yeah, anytime. We're just sorry. We kind of, when we hear ourselves saying that, we're just completely overjoyed. We really are. So,
and thank you to
yeah, let's give a huge thanks to Fleming, who tolerates us every single year. Fleming and I have been stand by side.
He's secure a high level with everything, with two cameras and drone and good sound, and yeah it's important.
And we could spend a minute talking about that, because we've got two drones out there actually, positioned two different places. And throughout the race, in the beginning, we'll have another drone out there. And we've got a camera on the starting line, which is actually filming straight across the line. And then other than that, we've got the two cameras here as well. So we've got three cameras set up.
Yeah.
One which is stationary, so we can document whether boats have passed the starting line before time, which I don't think anybody has this year.
No, it's very professional, live covering.
Thanks very much. So all from here, thanks Trolls, thank you Fleming, thanks for all of you for watching and listening in. Talk to you soon.